Hallelujah. 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 Father, we thank you for your amazing love. Hallelujah. Father, we thank you for the working of the Holy Spirit in our lives. Father, we thank you that you made us your people, that you are our God, that we've been redeemed by your precious blood, that we've been filled with your Spirit, Holy Spirit. Lord, we ask now in Jesus' name that you take full control of every dimension of our lives, of everything that belongs to us. Father, these strongholds of these last days, Father, we pray in the name of Jesus that every one of you people will be fit and equipped to be able to deal with the onslaught of all that the enemy is trying to do to stop the flow and the glory that you gave to us when you brought us to life in you through this new birth. Father, we pray right now for the Nostokorimayan, the Beshipronbideyashi, an overpowering work of your divine love and grace in every person's life that is here in this place and those that are watching on the web or by YouTube. Father, we pray in the name of Jesus that no power that is in this present world that belongs to the realms of the demonic, that belongs to the realms of Antichrist, that belongs to the realms of the spirit of darkness, would be able to operate in a single one of you people. That every single person here in this place, consecrated to you, O God, will begin to be multiplied by the thousands. Father, that every person in this place, O God, and every person that is gathered around your throne right now will begin to be multiplied, O God, by the thousands and by the tens of thousands. Father, we pray in the name of Jesus that there would come such a Holy Ghost conviction, Father, there would be no way that we would allow the things of this world to be a part of that which we are thinking and doing and the way in which we're living. But we discern the time that we're in right now and be sober and be vigilant like never before. And there won't be compromises, Father, we pray in the name of Jesus. Hallelujah. You can be seated. I pray tonight in the name of Jesus that if there's sickness or disease in your body, that it will go out. I pray in the name of Jesus that if there's fatigue or problems in your life to where that you just don't have to get up and go to go do the things that Father should give you a heavenly vision to do, that you would have that strength and that passion and that energy and that ability by the divine working of the Holy Ghost in your life, and those things that would try to shut that down, those things that would try to neutralize you, penetrate your life, enter into your life and subdue you, that you won't allow them anymore. Dear me, this is the last days. And in the last days, we understand what's going to happen. We understand that wickedness is going to abound more and more. Sin's going to abound more and more. We know that because iniquity will abound, the love of many will wax cold. We know what the satanic realm is doing. It's obvious. Look around. There's never been such a demonstration of sexual immorality as there is now. You've got to have to talk about it, preach about it more. You're going to have to be equipped to deal with it more, because I'm telling you, it's not just some kind of thing that belongs to a human bodily function. It's a principle of darkness. It's an authority that belongs in the realms of spiritual wickedness that dominates people's lives and minds. And the impact that it's having in the church is also evident. Because when the church walks in the authority that we're supposed to walk in, where those kinds of things have no place in our lives, then they don't overrun the society and the community in which we live as they have. Because right now, I just tell you right now, at this very moment in time, that we are in a position that I can't even begin to even imagine, because never in the history of man has it been recorded that there was any culture or society that was so so demonic, so overrun by darkness, so beside itself in logic and rationalization even, that they would try to do what they've done here in the United States of America to make a marriage between a man and a man and a woman and a woman equal to that of a man and a woman. Never in the history of men. That's just one of many tokens. Just to try to defy God. To take the token of the covenant that God made when he destroyed all life upon the face of the earth because of their wickedness and because of the imagination of their heart was only evil continually. And God then makes a covenant and puts a rainbow describing his love and his grace and his mercy to sustain men. And then such vile immorality takes and hijacks the symbol of that covenant. Then lights up the White House, which represents this nation. That house represents the nation. It's pretty radical. People don't understand what times we're living in right now. People don't get it. And tonight I'm a minister on things to you from the scripture, so that you can gird up the loins of your mind, so that you can be sober and vigilant, because your adversary, the devil, goes about as a roaring lion, seeking whom he may devour. We try to make sin common and ordinary. There's nothing common and ordinary about it. I'll tell you right now, if there's any kind of these things working in your life, you better cut yourself off from every entrance that it can get to you until you are equipped with the authority to turn away from it every time. Because the opening of her door and the entrance of her house leadeth unto hell, and those that go in there will never return again. And so it's time that people begin to make the consecration, begin to make the covenant, begin to make the separation that God demands. And I just feel so strong tonight just to encourage you in this area, and especially knowing, see, God said that he defiles the temple. He said he would destroy it, that soul in hell. And he describes one thing above all other things that destroy the temple. He says fornication, or which is really a Greek word, means porneia. The porneia is just literally means all sexual immorality. If there's any place, dear people, you need to grab a hold of yourself and keep yourself pure and separate yourself in every way. No, I don't care if you're single or if you're married. I'm going to tell you right now, that is the place of the biggest satanic attack. And it's not something that's covert. It's not something that's subtle. It is so blatantly obvious in our society and in our culture right now that nobody should be a moment in doubt about where the big battlefront is spiritually. Oh, masetere naashe. Tonight, the beautiful thing is that we can grab a hold of the blood of Jesus Christ and be cleansed, and the authority that is in his name, and deal with the principalities and the spiritual wickedness that would come out against us to destroy us along with the rest of the world that now is under its power and under its grip. And then in that glorious place of God's mercy and grace, we can walk in the authority of the Holy Ghost to go set other people free to stop the advancement of it. So I just want to spend some time tonight just talking to you really about moving into the realms of interaction with the Father. This morning we talked to you about a particular Hebrew word, Noam, which is translated many times beautiful. And respect of Lord, let your beauty return unto us. Let the beauty of the Lord our God be upon us, as the psalm says in Psalms 90, verse 17. And it means his goodness, his glory, his majesty, his splendor. The anointing that he of his life, and the anointing of his own person, and the anointing of his divine nature and power that he's made available to us that somehow we've not laid hold on as we ought to, that we've not devoted ourselves to as we should, because we've not really encountered the beauty and the splendor of it that he would desires to reveal to us. I just pray tonight that you so grab a hold of these things in the spirit, you so lay hold upon them, that your soul, your passions, your emotions, everything about you is unwilling to live without that which Father demands for us to have. You're unwilling to live without the beauty of his anointing, the beauty of his glory, the manifest presence of the living God in your life. To be walking around as the untouchables, where Satan has no access to you. The living epistles written of God and read of men. The sons of God with authority over all the powers of darkness, over all sickness and disease. Those who have special access into his presence, who walk in a oneness with him, that all creation groans right now waiting to see the manifestation of it. It really isn't so much, I don't really believe it's so much about our pleading and our much asking. I believe it is about our desperate need, because the word that we usually translate seek is an earnest desire that will not be turned away. It's an earnest desire, like the person with bold determination that's not going to go away, that's banging on the door of the house of his neighbor saying, open up and give to me, because I've got a friend that's just come and visit and I have nothing to set before him. And he's not going to go away until everything that he's been asking, everything that he's been seeking, everything that he's been knocking for is realized in his life. He's not going to be deterred. He's not going to be distracted by other things. He's got a passion. He's got one heart, one desire. And that's what he's seeking after. And pray tonight in Jesus' name that such a reality becomes a present working of divine power in you right now, something that you just God grabs a hold of you. He apprehends you in it. Hallelujah. During the days of Daniel, God would come to bring quickly to Daniel the revelation of those things that which he asked for, the authority of his word that would ultimately bring the release. But there was a power of darkness that had a stronghold over mankind at the time. And so because of that stronghold, and it was referred to as the Prince of Persia at the time, a demonic power, that which God wanted to do and that revelation which he wanted to give and that authority that he wanted to impart was not able, as it were, to come and be revealed to Daniel, because as Michael the archangel said, as Gabriel said, when he came to Daniel, your prayer was heard from the first moment, but there was a battle and a war going on because there was an authority, as it was, over your life, and access to you wasn't, as it were, permitted without a fight. Today, that same kind of thing happens through the power of sin, through the power of wickedness and ungodliness and wrong thinking. There's only one means by which that's removed, and that is just to turn to God with a repentant heart and let the blood of Jesus Christ wash you and cleanse you. And then that authority is removed. But I'm telling you, with that repentance, that authority of wickedness that would block the provision that God has for us is as effective now, or even could even say even more effective now than it was in Daniel's day. And people don't have to go and try to make up things. I'm telling you right now, when God the Holy Ghost is moving, he just shows things. People don't move into the authority and the anointing. They don't move into the expression of divine power and glory as God demands and God desires, simply because they're not willing to deal with the problems and the issues. Listen to me. The beautiful thing of it is, as we come into the presence of the Lord, he begins to expose them. No reason to run and hide. Father's saying he wants to walk with us. He's calling out to us. He's got things he wants to do in our life, but we can't be in the midst of being overrun with all the things of the powers of darkness. Father's given us authority to tread upon scorpions and serpents and over all the power of the enemy so that nothing can by any means hurt us, touch us, prevent us from all that he has for us. He's given us the ability to tread upon the adder and the lion and the dragon, as it says in Psalms 91, over everything that would describe the powers of darkness that would ruthlessly come and destroy and slay and kill men. We're going to have to rise up in the authority of God's word and learn how to live in a place consecrated, separated unto God, a place where Satan cannot access. I'm telling you right now, I'm just going to talk to you about a sin-free zone. Listen to me. As a person starts living a consecrated life under the Lord, it becomes expressed in their voice and in the words that come forth out of their heart and out of their mouth. Hallelujah. The anointing has just that much more impact through your life as you'll give yourself over to God. And different people are hindered by different things. And I just want you to let the spotlight of heaven shine upon your soul tonight. And just let God show you the things that you've been allowing, the things that you've been thinking, the things that you've even been doing, the things that you of darkness that you've allowed to access you, that you've made it somehow ordinary or commonplace and not identified it for the iniquity that it is, the enemy of your soul, but it is. I would that I never have to talk to God's people like this. I would rather just talk to God's people about how to stand over in the glory, how to stand over in the continually minister before the Lord, and in that passion and that hunger to know him, have an ever-increasing encounter with him. An ever-increasing encounter with him is far better than an ever-increasing faith. Hey, listen to me. Yes. An ever-increasing encounter with God produces an ever-increasing faith. Not something that looks like it was last year or 10 years ago or 20 years ago, but something that is so beautiful and glorious. Moses wasn't talking. I'll just tell you right now, when Moses came down off of the mount, having passionately pursued God in such a way that Father did not restrain anymore, did not restrain anymore the revelation of all of his glory to Moses. He didn't come down. He wasn't talking about... Even the day before, he went and talked about all that God did at the burning bush. All that God had done, you know, so many years before. He came radiating with the glory of that encounter that he had that day. Hallelujah. He dorasam bestikornaya. When you leave off seeking the things of the Spirit. You know, I see so many people so all wrapped up in what they think God isn't doing that they miss out on all the opportunities to move in what God is doing right now. It is amazing to me the amount of criticism that people will allow in their life, and they're nothing going to shut down the anointing and the move of God quicker than a critical spirit. Somebody always seeing what's not happening. Give me a break. God's doing so many things that it's about time God's people become aware of all the wonderful and glorious things that he's doing and the things that he set his heart to do and the things that he's described in his word that he would do. And so that your heart's set upon that, you're passionately pursuing that which God is doing right now. You're not going to be so easily run down by the enemy. Yeah. Are you listening to me? I believe that if we don't understand the tactics of the enemy, if you don't really understand how Satan is effectively stopping you, if you've never stopped long enough to listen to God, it just really kind of starts like this. Lord, what's keeping me holding me back from being used more by you? And that's not just for the preacher to talk about. That's every single person. You, a son of God, the daughter of the Most High, the children of the living God. Father's given us the authority to be his sons, to walk in his light as he is in the light, to be in this world even as he is. Hallelujah.
to live out the light that he demonstrated 2,000 years ago, gave us the same miracle, new birth, and same anointing, all the things that more than what we could ever ask, filled us up with his glory, baptized us in his Holy Ghost. All we got to do is begin to get serious with God and say, Lord, what's holding me back? What's standing in the way? The Lord's going to respond. He's going to talk to you. It's going to become so gigantic. It's going to become so big and so apparent before you. And then all you got to do is turn away from it. And then sometimes Papa's going to, you know what I'm telling you right now? If one of God's servants turns to me and says, listen, you're disturbing me. You know what? I'm going to feel like, you know what? I need to get right with God. How are you listening to me? And people say, well, you know, that person, they said that what was coming out of my mouth and the way I was expressing things, that it was disturbing them. They must have a problem. Right? Because it's everybody but you. Isn't that correct? Oh, Lord, we know that everybody's in need but me kind of thing. Are you listening to me? God, the Holy Ghost, looking for some people whose hearts are wide open to be reproved and to be corrected and be instructed in the ways of God and the ways of the Spirit of the Lord. We've got to recognize that Father has given such authority and such glory to the church that there is no excuse for us to have anything less than what he's described. And if we're making excuses for us to have less than what he's described, there's obviously we're going to be robbed of any passion to go after that which we're lacking as an evidence that there's something going on in our life that shouldn't be going on. And a willingness to then humble ourselves before God, let him correct us, let him show us, then we can then eschew evil. That means not allow it, abhor it, turn away from it, give it no place in our lives. People, you live in a very wicked society. It's called Southern California. You live inundated with so many people running around here. How many I think it is? Something like 14 million in Southern California. And the majority of those people are under the influence of wickedness. They give their thoughts and their talents and their activity to every ungodly thing. And we're going to have to understand how that we're going to be effective to minister as the ambassadors of the kingdom of God, to destroy the powers of darkness, to run them off, to move them out of the way. I guarantee you, Jesus come into Southern California, it'd be revival starting tonight. There'll be a great awakening starting tonight. Hello. Yes. Paul dealt with the wickedness of a goddess, the queen of heaven, who dominated mankind with her religion for at least up to that moment in time, at least 3,000 years. 2,500 to 3,000 years. This is definitely since the days of Nimrod. And he took it on as like it were single-handedly and brought down the power of it. Because God had given the authority to turn men from darkness to light, from the power of Satan to the power of God, to turn them, to open up their eyes, their spiritual eyes, so that they would be able to see the reality of heaven and hell, the reality of the presence of God, and the reality of the enemy of their soul. And Father's given you and I the same authority. He's given us the same ability. He's made us his ambassadors. He's given to us his same Holy Ghost that he gave to Paul. He's given us the same power. But what's happened is that somehow we've allowed that wonderful grace that was poured out upon us to be somehow mixed and contaminated with things that belong to this world that gives the powers of darkness an authority to hinder us and to stop the flow and to stop the access that otherwise would exist. To stop the flow of his divine provision spiritually and materially, but especially spiritually. So as we let this floodlight of heaven shine upon our soul tonight, see, the reason I'm talking like this, I wasn't planning on ministering like this. I'm just standing out there having open visions of what's going on, of what's going on in different people's lives. I'm just going, and it's like, I don't want to see that. Lord, I don't, please, I want to preach something. I'd like to minister about something else. Bang, right there, back at me. Jesus. Dear people, what I'm saying is we're together in this thing, and we're going to have to turn our hearts towards God, and we're going to have to start praying and interceding for one another. We're going to have to start passionately pursuing the things that the Spirit of the Lord has given us opportunity to have instead of passionately pursuing all the other opportunities that exist out there. Hello. Listen, dear people, I want everybody in this place to know tonight, I am not and you should not be interested in money and gonna do much at all for you. You should not be at all interested in wealth. It does not matter. In fact of it is, the pursuing of it, you are thrust yourself through with many darts. There are many pitfalls in it. You hear me? There are many opportunities to be deceived by the powers of darkness, people pursuing things. I mean, I'm telling you right now, I get a little concerned when everybody gets excited about promoting different products. And I was like, before they weren't an evangelist that strong of an evangelist for the things of the kingdom. Now they're an evangelist for all this other stuff. It bothers me. I understand everybody needs to go to work and everybody needs to make finances, but I'm going to tell you right now, God will make you wealthy. He will make you rich. Ned and Sarah, he'll promote you into things of the Spirit. If you're doing what he's called you to do, there can't be mixtures going on in your life. There's not a thing in your life that you should have as something that's for your own self-gain and for your own self-interest in the pursuit of an earthly existence. Come on now. I mean, everything needs to just be consecrated to the Lord in our lives on another level. Do you think that, I mean, I believe that the Lord is continually calling us to a place of consecration and surrender to him. I believe that the Lord is continually calling us to a place of total abandonment to live out the glorious life that he has for us. Total abandonment of our own visions, our own passions, our own interests, our own pursuits, to be able to embrace everything that he's freely given to us. I mean, we're going to have to let the things that we read about in the Bible be more important to us than the things that we've read about in this earth. We got to let the things that God has said to us be more important to us than the things that men have said to us. We got to let the opportunities that have been given to us in heaven be bigger to us than the opportunities that exist in the earth. Let me just begin to just sort out a few verses of scripture for you. Just people think just because something's big and everybody's all excited about it that it's God. It may be more of an evidence that it's not God. You hear me? Jesus said, broad is the way that leads to destruction, narrow is the way that leads to life. He said, many go on the way that lead to destruction, and few there be found on the way that leads unto life. Can you begin to grab a hold with me tonight, just begin to sense a divine opportunity that you have to begin to light up with the glory of heaven? Yes. When the anointing is there, everything else is there too. Glory and honor and riches is there in his house. When the anointing is there and the Holy Ghost Spirit is allowed to have his way, there is every provision of heaven. You are occupied and preoccupied with what's going on in the throne room rather than what's going on in a world full of sin and iniquity. Look with me in a couple of verses of scripture here in Ephesians. Let's just turn to Ephesians chapter 5. Obviously, as I've already said, I wasn't prepared to even begin to talk about this tonight. Because I felt that the Lord was going to take me in another direction. But I'm just going to go with what's most needful and what's most important. Listen, dear people, listen to me. Nothing matters but fearing God and keeping His commandments. Nothing else even matters. Nothing else is even important but being found in Christ Jesus on that day. If there's something that's going on in your life that is diluting that interest, that is distracting you from the fundamental reality of the day that you're going to stand and give an account of for your soul before the living God, you need to get rid of that stuff. Whatever's diluting your focus, whatever is distracting you from the most important thing. You know what we measured this morning on how this so much of the will of the Father is just found in us delighting ourselves in Him and being one with Him and finding ourselves in a place of loving Him and knowing Him. That in that communion with Him, that fellowship with Him, that fear and shame and condemnation would try to run interference against. We find everything that would empower us to begin to move into a place of living in a sin-free zone, living in an authority over all the powers of darkness. It's not in focusing on the don'ts. It's rather in focusing on the do's. It's focusing on the privilege and the opportunity that we have access into His presence, that we have the privilege of being overwhelmed with the glory of the Spirit of the Lord and having this opportunity to have the rivers of God activated in our life and flowing through us with all the demonstration of heaven and all the demonstration of His power and all the demonstration of His glory. All the demonstration of the person of Jesus. See, the person of Jesus, if He was allowed in our lives to be as Father has purposed Him to be revealed in our lives, there'd be an awakening in Southern California tonight. I stand in need. And from my perspective, you stand in even more need. Because it looks to me like I'm doing a whole lot more than you're doing. I don't even mean to make some comparisons here. I'm just trying to point out a few things, just saying, as they say. Where is our pursuit at? And if our pursuit and our direction and our vision is messed up, I'm going to tell you right now, there is going to be a cascade of events that are going to compromise us, that's going to leave us in a place from the whole spectrum of just being deadhead religious to being overrun with sin and iniquity. The whole spectrum of it. Abrabo se vectia na balama se vetero soton. Ebre mengi pasta telenepia shalopa kuraste. Well, Lord, I just ask You right now for the work of divine grace, for Your precious blood to bring things in order. Because if there's one thing, you know, I'm real quick to do. If I see things that are out of order, I'm real quick to repent and get things back into order. Because there's no reason to let things go completely into total chaos. There's no reason that things just continue to decay and get worse and worse. Just when we all have the opportunity to cry out to God and say, Father, come rescue us, come and deliver us. Why let things continue on and erode and get worse? Why do that? When you can call out to a Savior who will come and save you and come and help you and change the situation right there. Why is it that people are willing to stand back and let Satan do whatever he wants to do? Are you listening to me? Yes. I mean, I don't even want to allow a little indication that Satan is doing something, that there is something that is out of order, there's something that is not of the Spirit of the living God. Not in my children, not in my life, not in my family, not in my friends, not in the church, no, not in any place. Am I going to stand by and just watch something that is wrong and not pursue it and say it and shut it down? Hello. Because if you don't, it's going to take you, it's going to destroy everything you got. And then what are you going to do with yourself? You stand before the Lord, what are you going to do? Oh, well, God, I just did my very best to just, you know, let everybody do whatever they wanted to do. And he's going to say, well done, my good and faithful servant. You're just so passionate about pursuing my heavenly vision. So passionate about shutting down the devil and the powers of darkness everywhere that you encountered them. Jesus was manifested to destroy the works of the devil. What are you doing? Are you listening to me?
Yes.
This is the life of Christ Jesus, to shut down the works of Satan, to destroy the prince of the power of the air everywhere he is encountered. And beginning in their own lives, and as I ministered this morning, in the realms of our own thinking. Because what most people don't understand is that you can't isolate your thoughts from all other influences. To say, well, this is purely just my thoughts that originated from me and me alone without any kind. Go ahead, take care of your baby. Without any kind, you can bring him here. I'll pray for him. He's probably not feeling well. I want to take care of him. Lord, touch the baby right now in Jesus' name. Now, as I mentioned this morning, there's no way for you to isolate your thoughts. To be able to say, this is just my thoughts, unimpacted by any influences around me, both of men and of darkness. There's no way. The only way you're going to be able to live out your life properly is where you begin to let the Word of God and the Spirit of God, where the Spirit of God is always going to do what the Word of God is doing, dominate your thoughts. And that's going to be a battlefield. You're going to have to deal with all kinds of things that you've allowed to run rampant in your thinking that are purely and 100% influenced by the demonic realm. And either by way of your culture, by the way of your influences, the people that you associate with, the opinions of men, or directly by demonic spirits who are, you know, is described by Paul as though they are throwing fiery darts at you. Which, of course, the shield of faith will quench every one of them. But the shield of faith is a direct result of you living over in the glory. I mean, those are just Holy Ghost songs we were singing tonight. It's just beautiful. You just give yourself to that kind of activity. Come on, man. Yes. I mean, I'm just saying, every one of us need to be giving ourselves over to a work of the Holy Ghost in our life that is continually producing and outworking a flow of something that is going to be a blessing to the household of faith, to the church of the Lord Jesus Christ, that's going to be liberating to the world around us. Yes. And you may not have a voice. You may not be able to sing. We're not telling you all need to become, you know, some kind of, you know, worship leaders in that sense. But Father has something for you to do. There's some dimension of the grace. There's some dimension of the glory. There's some dimension of the beauty. There's some dimension of the splendor. Every one of us have the splendor and the authority of the sonship position that have been given to us, being sons of God. But it matters nothing if you sit back and watch the devil run over all that you have. You listening to me?
Yes.
Where's your passion? Huh? You got to think about that. Where is my passion? Am I going to let Satan steal my kids? Am I going to let Satan run havoc in my life and in my family with disease and with doubt and with oppression? Am I going to let him do those kinds of things, overwhelm me with those kinds of things, even in my thinking realm? Hello? Am I going to be passionate and aggressive about the Word of God and living under His sovereign rule and living under His sovereign authority? Because He's given me the weapons of this warfare, which are mighty. But I mean, really, reality of it is that you need to be effectively utilizing that which God has given you. But unless a demarcation has truly come in your life, and once again, that comes back to, in some respects, just recognizing how exceedingly sinful sin is. Some people just think it's common and ordinary, like I said. It's terrible. It's worse than terrible. God abhors it. It's worse than God abhorring it. His wrath abides on it. And so much worse than that, he's going to destroy it with exceeding. How great is his wrath? How can you measure the anger of his power? Huh? Or the power of his anger? As we minister to you in Psalms 90. And I hope that you understood very clearly the bridge that we set up by the Holy Ghost between Psalms 90 and Psalms 91 this morning. If you weren't here, I encourage you to watch the video or the YouTube. It's probably going to be lengthy, but I'm sure it'll be beneficial.
Yes.
How excited are you about your authority in God? How much do you lean to the arm of flesh rather than leaning to the anointing and relying upon the Spirit of the Lord to solve the issues, to solve the problems, to bring the provision to whatever needs you may have. Even the fussy babies. Huh? Children who are a little bit irritable get a little bit irritable. It has to be discipline in the house. There has to be order in the house. It's essential. Let me just talk just a little bit about this. I would rather talk about the glory. I would rather talk about the beauty of the new covenant that God has available for us that was seen on Moses' face there when he returned from off the mountain meeting with God and beheld the glory of God, which Father revealed to us by his servant Paul, was a testimony of the new covenant you and I now stand in, where he's there declaring the law of God, where he's there declaring God's anger and hatred and condemnation against all sin and death. The death that was there, the sin that was there, and the condemnation that was there in their life. And he's standing there preaching such a radical sermon with the glory glow on his face. That brings changes.
Yes.
Huh?
Yes.
I guarantee you it wasn't the letter that kills right then. It was the Spirit that was declaring the life of God. Because it was the Holy Ghost speaking through him. Are you listening to me?
Yes.
It wasn't reduced to a religious letter. Are you listening?
Yes.
You understand?
Yes.
Stephen's face, he was laying into those folks. He was showing them exactly what their wickedness was and the hardness of their own heart and the stubbornness of their life. But his face was shining like an angel when they went to biting him and hitting on him. I mean, that's some serious anger for adults to go biting into someone.
Right.
I mean, the beauty of what Peter was able to step into, hallelujah, in his walk and relationship with the Lord, where his shadow, at the very just a shadow, people said, Peter's coming to town, get your sick, lay him in the street. He don't even need to pray for you. His shadow. Just his shadow. Falling on you, anointing in the shadow, a communication of the presence of God in every dimension of your life, an authority to shut down what Satan is doing. There's no excuses. People always make excuses. Well, this happened and that happened. No, you abdicated your authority and you gave yourself over to let the enemy run over your soul and run over your life. He's a rebellious imp. He is going to try to impose upon you things that he has no rights to impose upon you. You have to understand what God has given you, the authority that he's given to you, the anointing that he's given to you. You got to understand his relationship that he's provided for us to have, where he's with us and in us. I mean, there's nothing that can stop us. No weapon formed against us can prosper. My goodness. All we got to do is change.
Yeah.
All we got to do is let go of our life to have his life. All we got to do is passionately pursue the things he has for us rather than passionately pursuing the things that we have for us. And then the mixture of it. I don't care if it's a 50-50, a 70-30, an 80-20, a 90-10. It's still going to create problems when you mix your interest with God's interest. Yeah. It's going to open you up to compromise. It's going to open you up to being that much more vulnerable to the things the satanic realm would try to impose upon you. One of the beautiful things about the blood of Jesus Christ and you and I coming to understand the faith of it and the mercy of it and the covenant of it is that it removes from off of us all sin and all iniquity so that there is no shame and there is no condemnation and there is no fear. There is no sense of separation at all between us and the Lord. That is absolutely essential in our interaction with him if we're going to be able to receive that which he's freely given. You don't have to earn nothing with God. He's freely given it. But there has to be obedience. There has to be obedience. And I'm going to tell you right now, if you don't think obedience is taught and obedience is learned, you checked out of life somewhere. You checked out of reality. Christ Jesus learned obedience. Huh? Love is going to demand it. Love is going to have it. No matter what the cost. I hope you can hear me. Look with me in Ephesians chapter 5. The Lord, he's calling us. He says, be therefore, verse 1, he says, be followers of God. Be imitators of God as beloved children. Hallelujah. That is a word of fellowship and relationship. Walk in love as Christ also has loved us. These are the rules. This is the call. You know this, you've heard me say this many times. I can tell you where to get perfect love. Is there anybody here hasn't heard me tell you how to get perfect love? I can tell you how to get perfect love. 1 John 4:18 says, we have known and believed the love of God that God has for us. God is love. Herein is our love made perfect. Amen. Knowing, believing the love that God has for us. Herein is our love made perfect that we may have boldness in the day of judgment. And we understand what perfect love is going to do. It's going to drive out all fear. What's going to go with fear? Condemnation, shame, intimidation, all the rest of that mess that came in as a flood as soon as Adam disobeyed. The same reality that you and I live on a daily basis. Because God's given us the opportunity now and through the new birth to make the choices every day that Adam made that one day. Are we going to obey God or are we going to disobey him? And I'm going to tell you right now, disobedience has the same kind of a consequence. It allows Satan to begin to influence you, to begin to work a work against you, to begin to try to attempt to stop the flow and the blessings of God from getting to you. I mean, he fought real hard against Daniel, like 21 days or something. Michael the archangel came and helped him, and they prevailed. There was war going on in heaven to be able to get past the satanic interference and stronghold that was allowed to be erected because of man's sin and iniquity. Huh? Because God had given them over to their enemies to dominate them. You hear what I'm saying? It's true. How is it, dear people, how is it that we can live without a Holy Ghost flow in our life on a daily basis? How is it that we could be willing to live without the glory of his manifest presence, without walking with him, talking with him? How is it that we could abdicate the authority that is given to us and not have before us a passionate heart to enter into that realm that we have access by the Spirit? Into right now. I want to make, God wants to make these things real to you. God wants to make your access into the heavenly real to you. He wants to move it beyond the four walls of the church. He wants to move it beyond just an events that happen when we come together as the body of Christ. That should be the culmination. That should be the highlight of our relationship. I'm going to tell you right now, what you really are spiritually is exposed in the midst of the church. Come on now. We want you to see you rise up and begin to flow in all the beauty and all the splendor that has been freely given to you. Everything that Jesus has, all of his glory, of his fullness, have all we received. Hello. To be baptized, the expressions of God bursting out of us like rivers. When that's not happening, and you believe this is the living reality and not some kind of hyperbole or spiritual exaggeration or something that is really an unseen thing that is not a living reality with a living real result and consequence, you have to then deal with yourself. And you know what's going to probably, you know what's going to come down to more than anything? It's going to come down to your passion. It's going to come down to your hunger. You know what that's going to come down to? What you really believe. It's going to come down to the faith realm. The Word of God. Faith is literally the expressions of the Word of God through you and me. That's what faith is. It's expressions of the Word of God through you and me. And the Holy Ghost supplies the faith. Faith comes by hearing the Word, and then the expression of the Word of God through our life is actually the outworking, the evidence, hallelujah, the demonstration of faith. To really believe that these things are ours. To where that you wake up in the morning and begin to touch heaven. It's more important to you than toast and coffee or whatever it is you have, scones and coffee. Whatever else you may have, Krispy Kreme donuts and coffee. God forbid that you should so do such a thing. That's terrible. Better just have a pack of cigarettes or something. I'm just letting you know about it. It was just. Defile yourself some other way. Destroy your body some other way. Don't destroy your body at all. Amen. Don't mess with it at all. Eat healthy things. Don't eat things that are going to make you depressed and fatigued. Huh? Eat healthy things. Somebody said, well, it's just hard. I can't afford healthy food. Then take the food that you can't afford, pray over it, and let a miracle take place, and everything become transformed right there. Ask God to put the nutrients in it and take all the bad stuff out and put all the good stuff in. Amen, Jesus' name. But don't do that over a Krispy Kreme donut, because Father will not be mocked. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. You know, when first and foremost, when we hear walking in love, we've got to just hear the supply of the Spirit that is given to us to be able to love Father. See, hearing is love, not that we loved God, but that He loved us. But the Holy Spirit has poured this love into our hearts so that we can begin to love Him the way He loves us. We're loving Him with the love wherewith He's loved us. And then that same love and a relationship response with Father and a passion to know Him, to obey Him, to do His will, to walk it out, to not allow Satan any place to work in our life. Listen, I'm there's some things I saw this morning just is so sad. It's so wrong. It's just so wrong. where people are allowed to so drift from God and so be given over to the enemy. Jesus. Dear people, pursue your family for the kingdom of God. Pursue your friends for the kingdom of God. How do you pursue them? Through prayer and an authority where you can rise up and be used of God to turn them from Satan to God. My goodness gracious. From the power of darkness to the power of God. I'm going to tell you right now, some of you need to just do this because you need to stir some passion in you, because I don't see what needs to be going on. Huh? You need to stir some passion. You need to stir some holy zeal. You need to have some fiery indignation going on. That's good, Geneva. Because when you obey, when you want it so bad, you're willing to do it no matter how foolish it looks. Oh, Jabatara Musikina Lamasete. I'm really compelled. I don't want to embarrass you, Joseph, but your family, I'm just so concerned about your children. And we just need to pray and just believe God. Somebody's going to have to get passionate. Actually, you the one who holds the key. We can all pray, but God, that's your seed. Father himself gave man, the man of the house, the authority to determine how it's going to go down. But if you don't believe that authority, ain't nothing going to happen. You're not able to move out in that authority and activate that authority, you abdicate and nothing's going to happen. You got to stand up and be willing to lose your life pursuing the will and purposes of God. Hello, people. You need to stir things up in your life to where that you're not willing to be disobedient. Hello. The beautiful thing of it is that the Lord's mercy and grace continues to deal with us and to produce within our life godly sorrow that would work repentance in our life until we get a handle on just how real these choices are and the intensity of the consequences within the framework of our choice. We live in perilous times. We live in a time where scoffers and mockers have greater influence, and they continue to increase, and they continue to try to dominate what we think and dominate what we do with their voice. But we're the people of God, and they shouldn't even be able to touch us. You hear me? You let Satan run over top of you with his stuff, with his lies, with his iniquity, with his influence, and he's going to completely take you over. If he can't completely take you over, he's going to neutralize you. Anybody ever feel neutralized? Hey, how many of you feel neutralized? I have a lot. You know what I do? I hit my face. Some of you, I don't know why you didn't raise your hand, because just everybody in this place has been neutralized more than once. What, are you living that deep of a denial? You're living in denial. God wants to set you free. You part the sea. Amen. So you can leave Egypt. Amen. Come on. Listen to me. Participate. Amen. It's not a trick question. I can put it this way. How many souls have you brought into the kingdom this year? If you just tell me 100, sounds to me like you're neutralized. You know what I'm saying? Yeah. Sounds like to me like you're not being very effective. Are you listening to what I'm saying? Yeah. And is there condemnation with that? No. No. It's a stirring you up to say, wait a minute. I know that God loves me. I know it's about not about what I do. I know it's about just my willingness to respond to him and obey him. It's not based upon the magnitude, you know, of these kinds of works. It is about obedience in the sense of what I do. But being with him and being around him and interacting with him and fellowshipping with him is going to stir you up with the Holy Ghost passion and the Holy Ghost fire. That it is not going to be works for you to just shine with the glory glow of heaven. It's going to be wonderfully exciting. You with me? Your shadow having such impact on people's life is wonderfully exciting. Going to bed at night and having visions and dreams is wonderfully exciting. Hallelujah. A consecrated life to the Lord makes all the difference. Hear me. A consecrated life to the Lord makes all the difference. A consecrated life to the Lord that says, when you do stumble up into something, you become so sorrowful and so overwhelmed with it because of the impact it has on the most dearest and most wonderful relationship that's unimaginable that you have with the Father, that you have with the Holy Ghost, and you have with Jesus. You ain't going to have it again. You ain't allow it again. Jesus. I'm looking around here tonight, and I'm wondering where people are at. There's so many people. I'm like, where are they at? Were they on vacation? If they're on vacation again, that means they're taking a vacation every other week. And I know what that is. It's because iniquity shall abound, the love of many shall wax cold. So instead of the first love burning within your heart, the passion to just be in the meeting, passionate to be in the flow, a passion, to know him, like he's given us the opportunity to know him, somehow begins to wane. That's serious backsliding. That's where you're backsliding. The Lord gives us the principle. He says, therefore, imitate God, be followers of God, follow him around, be led by him, do what it is he's doing as beloved children. Walk in love as Christ has loved us and has given himself for us, an offering, a sacrifice to God for a sweet-smelling savor. So I'm just walking around saying, Father, I thank you that my life is a sweet-smelling savor unto you. That I've been able this day to present my body a living sacrifice, that this day I get to walk out a life that is something that you're excited about, that I get to be an expression of that which you created man to be. Come on. What a way to live your life. You can go to work like this and it not be a problem. You can live out your life like this and there's a fellowship. Listen to me, dear people. I'm going to tell you right now, your kids are not going to have any more of a walk with God than you've got until you start modeling for them what it looks like to live out a heavenly relationship with the Almighty God, to walk in the Spirit, to be led by the Spirit, to live a supernatural life, to be constantly in expectation for the great outpourings of God to be expressed through your life. All those things that God said he wanted to do through us, that even the least among us would be able to turn 1,000 and 10,000 to flight, to cause the dead to rise to life again. The blind to see, to have authority over all the armies of hell. Come on now. One day the Lord's going to change the dynamics of all of this. I'm not going to be around during the tribulation. I'll either be dead or caught away. Hallelujah. And of course, when I say that I'll be dead or caught away, we know that we are which are alive and remain should not prevent them that are asleep, for the dead in Christ shall rise first. Amen.
Amen.
So that's what I mean by dead. Huh? I just won't be alive and be changed. I won't. So there's going to be a group of people that will not see death. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. Somebody said, and I thought it was just really good. Somebody said, well, if this is the Elijah generation, where are the Elijahs? Amen. I thought, well, that's very good. A good point. It's about time somebody starts seeing. It's about time we start seeing people live. That's a consecrated life. Look at Elijah. He wears the garments, the clothing of a consecrated life. Separated, completely isolated from everything else that's common and going on in ordinary. I love what Leonard Ravenhill said. Is the world crucified to you, or are you still fascinated by it? Because I'm discovering that people are fascinated by it in its clothing design, in its money that it has to provide, in its success, and its opportunities for advancement and vocation. God's got some opportunities for you if you begin to seek the heavenly opportunities. Suta Ramon Zisaya. Somebody said, are you saying we shouldn't work and go to our job? No, I'm not saying that. I'm just saying that the kingdom of God needs to be bigger than your work and your job. And if your work and your job's keeping you from seeking the kingdom of God, I say just be poor and live on the street. Till you get that straightened out. The reality of it is, if your job's keeping you from seeking the kingdom of God, you got a heart problem, so you'll have the same heart problems being, poor and on the street. So the reality of it is that you got a heart problem and you need a heart change and you got an issue, you got a stronghold in your life that you're not been willing to deal with. There's some places in God that you're not willing to walk with Him, and it's time to just go ahead and let that get sorted out. It's time to let the floodlight of heaven shine upon your soul. The spotlight of heaven come right on you. Let God put you in the star position, as it were. Amen. Let Father evaluate you. Let Him show you. Let Him teach you why He can't use you more. I believe some people think they bought into a lie. Oh, God isn't going to use me. He doesn't use everybody very much. Just a couple people uses a lot. The rest of us, just a cup of water. Ain't no cup of water ministries around here. It's Jesus' ministry. Ain't no cup of water ministries. That's nonsense. False doctrine is what that is. These signs should follow them that believe. Satan can't touch you. Sickness can't touch you. Disease can't touch you. Satan can't come steal what belongs to you. Satan's not stole one of my children. Not stolen one thing from me, and he can't steal it. Because I'm kept by the power of God, and I'm not bending nor bowed to his lies. And I encourage you in the name of Jesus, don't you bend or bow either. Don't you listen to his insults and his lies and his fear tactics and his intimidations and his suggestions and his imaginations and all those things that would begin to flood your mind that are contrary to the word of God, and then you'd begin to derive a conclusion or a direction or make a decision out of it. Because then you just opened up your life to come under the authority of something that would destroy you. Something that would steal from you. Something that would hinder you from that which Father has for you. Just begin to live by the Word of God. Live under the Word of God. Rise up in the boldness and the confidence and the authority of the Word of God. You better walk in love. Because if you don't walk in love, you just walked out of fellowship. You just walked away and joined leagues with the enemy of your soul in something. You better walk in love. You better walk in love as Christ loved us. How worthy of that love were you? Let me say that again. You better walk in love as Christ also loved you. How worthy were you of that love? He said, listen to me. We were alienated by wicked works. We were the enemy. When we were without God, when we were ungodly, without God, when we were enemies, He commended His love towards us. The household of faith now really is more, you know, at the forefronts of what Paul is saying here in Ephesians. It's at the forefronts. There's no question about that, of how we as the body of Christ interact with each other and committed to one another and are faithful in the things that God has supplied to us in His love, and then we treat one another out of that. That's first and foremost. But it extends to a lost and dying world. Here the principle here of having the provision of heaven such that all these things that Satan would try to do to you and through you aren't going to be able to have any effect. Huh? He says, but fornication and all uncleanness and covetousness, let it not be once named among you. In other words, be without spot. Don't do it. Have none of it. It's not supposed to ever be in your life. There is no, you're going to sin more or less every day in these things here. Do not let it be named one time. Don't let there be one event among a thousand of you, much less one event in your life. Hello. People wonder why the church isn't effective. Because leaven. Because of unrepented sin. Because the powers of darkness is able to stand against the provision of the living God and say, no, by their acts and by their deeds, they're mine. They're my servants. You stop with what you want to come and the provision you want to give and the blessings that you want to supply. Huh? Can you hear what we're saying?
Yes.
Can you hear what God's saying?
Yes.
Why would you sit there for a second and let Satan have such rights in the midst of the church of your life? I mean, you should rise up with just intensity.
Yes.
Father, we just thank you for such wisdom. We thank you for such passion. We thank you for such a flow, such a Holy Ghost flow, such a demonstration of your power and of your glory being expressed through our lives. Because I'm not going to look to myself. I'm not sufficient of these things of myself. I don't rely on myself. Our sufficiency is of God. I rely upon Him. Within myself, I can do nothing. I have no supply or ability in any way to be that which God's purposed me to be. But the Holy Ghost is here supplying me if I just yield myself to Him. If I'll recognize what is the right way and turn from the wrong way. And any place that there has been wrong in my life, or where I've allowed Satan or offense or death or sin to come, I take the blood of Jesus Christ. I cry out in true repentance before God. That thing is broken. It's removed. And I yield myself over to the Holy Ghost, who strengthens me and empowers me to do that which is right. Because He's the one who began this work, and He's the perfecter and the maturer and the completer of it. There has to be, we're just gonna have to stir some passion here. Kitoro mo Sunday. Just a couple people. Just like, I'm not having sickness, I'm not having disease, I'm not having sin, I'm not having iniquity, I'm not having poverty, I'm not having any suggestions, lies or imaginations. I'm not going to have any condemnation, I'm not having any fear, intimidation, I'm not having any shame, I'm not having anything that belongs to a realm of sin. I'm not having it. I won't allow it. I'm not allowing the thief to come and steal from me. You shouldn't allow it. You shouldn't allow the powers of darkness to overrun you. You shouldn't have excuses for yourself of why you do these things or why you are without that which God has supplied and promised and commanded. You should lay hold upon every dimension of the life that God has given. Lay hold. When we say lay hold on eternal life, we're talking about lay hold on the life of God, everything that He's promised, everything that is in His Word. Otherwise, you're going to be after other pursuits to fill your emptiness. You're going to feel empty and worthless because you don't have the life of Jesus Christ. There's only one vision to have, dear people. There's only one heavenly vision to have. Without it, you're going to perish. Without a vision, the people perish. And there's only one vision. The earth, if you start looking towards the earth, it will swallow you up. The earth will swallow you up. You turn your heart away from the means by which God has delivered His word for you, to you. You turn your heart away from the means by which He's brought such a great abundance of salvation and authority against all the powers of darkness. Listen, God demands that you and I stand up and speak His word the way He declared it to have the results that He has promised. Do you understand that? Do you understand that Father demands that you and I passionately pursue with a determination that is and a passion that is on the level of hunger and thirst if we're going to have what the kingdom of God has made available to us right now in this life. That is a whole lot of a display of determination. That is a huge display of a relentless pursuit for God, and probably the best way to describe it is a violence. The kingdom of God suffers violence, and the violent take it by force, saying, "Satan, you're not putting that stuff on me. I'm not going to lay down to it. I'm not going to agree with it on any measure, in any dimension." And there's different layers of that. And blatant, obvious sin and transgression against God on the level of sexual immorality is one of the worst displays of an antichrist, God-denying spirit. The fool has said in his heart, "There is no God." Well, to act like there is no judgment for your deeds is equally foolish. Amen. To live like God doesn't exist. To live like you're not going to stand before the judgment seat of Christ is equally foolish. Neither filthiness nor foolish talking nor jesting if you're the example that God has raised up to show the world what Father demands and you open up the door to things that are wickedness and unholiness, that are worldliness, that are contrary to His ways. I'm going to tell you right now, the Lord said it would be better that you didn't even enter into life. That's what Father said. Why? Because you create a stumbling block. Because people now are following you, and all of a sudden you're promoting things that belong to the spirit of this world, and other people stumbled in it. The Lord actually suggested suicide first. That's some wild doctrine, ain't it? He said it'd be better for you to tie a millstone around your neck and throw it into the sea. What? That's suicide. Hello? Before you go to that. The Lord is really extreme about this stuff, isn't he? He's like, puck your eye out first, man. Cut your hand off first. Get the axe out of your foot. God is extreme. Well, he must know something that the rest of us don't know. And that's why he's so extreme about it. He must recognize and see a forthcoming consequence for such ungodliness and activity. And he said, I'm telling you right now, it's better for you to come into the kingdom of God one-eyed than to enter into hell having both eyes, to be cast into hell. I believe God is very serious about his judgment. That's why Paul said, knowing the terror of the Lord, we thus persuade men. I'm trying to persuade you tonight. I'm trying to help you understand if there's any place in your life where you see a reoccurrence of the satanic in your life, where you just basically have temporary insanity. You forgot all wisdom. You become a temporary fool, void of understanding, void of judgment, void of the law and the ways of God. That's insanity. That is a deception, a power of deception. If there is a place in your life where the power of deception is able to work such a work, you need to cut that thing off. Satan has set it up. Where's my cell phone? Satan has set it up to where people walking around with access to the worst kinds of demonic things in their pockets. If you don't have authority, if you're not fit and equipped, you do not have the right to have a cell phone. Go back to the old model. They still have it available. They have AT&T still has available those lines. You hear me? Yeah. You remember the phones? Yeah. I just go back to the one that rings like this or whatever, you know, that you hold up to you. I mean, come on. Cut it off. Do not pass by it. Come on, people. You're living in perilous times. You're living in times where seducing spirits are worse and growing worse. They have a greater impact. The intensity of it, the influence of it is greater than any other time. These are the indications of the last day. When I look at Iran, ancient Persia, at the stronghold, as it were, of Assyria, Iran and Iraq joining now with Syria and Russia. I mean, it's like you're living in the book, of Revelation. You're living in the book of Daniel. It's like it's never been up to this level, but it's going to get worse because the things, that's why I wrote, the Lord inspired me to write this book that I'm just now finishing up called The Rise of the Seventh and the Eighth Kingdom, because there is going to be a global world war that will change the dynamics of our whole arrangements of nations before the seventh kingdom arises, which is the kingdom that exists when the tribulation starts. And as far as we know, in the way it's laid out, it is the kingdom that arises and exists the very day that the 70th week of Daniel's prophecies upon that he received from God concerning Israel begins, which is what we call a tribulation, or 7 years of tribulation. Things are getting ready to get really bad. You don't realize it. There's a world war about to take place that is like nothing that has ever been in world war in the history of modern times. The earth has been relatively quiet for 2,000 years. It's about to begin to erupt. You better get ready. You better get yourself, you better find out whose side you're on and get on the right side quick. As for me and my house, we'll serve God, and I'll demand it. I'm not sit around like some people just act like, you know, whatever is happening, there's nothing I can do about it. I tried. Lay down your life, man. Get at it. Go to jail if you need to. Whatever it takes. Take authority. You're not going to go to jail. The passive attitudes that people have in their response to the forceful, pushy disposition of the satanic realm. Satan will impose upon you. You understand me? He will force you. He's a tyrant. That Nimrod was an expression of, but the Antichrist is the full expression of him. Even as Christ Jesus was the full expression of the Father. And that's the level of wickedness that we're coming to, dear people. Hello. The restraint is being removed. The hinderer of iniquity is going to be removed. That full iniquity cannot be revealed until the hinderer of iniquity is removed. But what if the hinderer of iniquity is not even hindering nothing? What if the hinderer of iniquity is indeed the church, which I believe is the means by which God stands up in the midst of the world that we presently live in, but the church is itself overrun with iniquity? Who's doing any hindering then? I believe that if you're passive in one area, you're passive in every area. I believe if you don't pursue the authority of God in your life in one area, then it absolutely has an impact in every area of your life. It's like a domino. It's like dominoes lined up on the table. Just hit one. Brrr, they all go down. I just want you to get real with God. I want you to get real about the things that God's entrusted you with. I want you to believe all the authority that He's given to you. As many as received Him, He gave them the authority to be the sons of God. And that's huge authority. That's authority. The authority of the believer. That is the authority of the Lord Jesus Christ, the Son. That is the authority to tread upon scorpions and serpents and over all the power of the enemy. That is the authority to cast out devils, to speak with new tongues. You drink any deadly thing, it shall not hurt you. You take up serpents and suffer no harm. You lay your hands on the sick and they shall recover. Amen. It's authority to bind Satan. Yes. Whatever you bind on earth is bound in heaven. Right. Whatever you ask the Father, He will do. Yes. Because He set His affections upon me. When He calls, I will answer. Yes. Because He's known my name, I'll set Him up on high. That's what Jesus Christ has brought us into. He's brought us into this place where we now live in the secret place of the Most High. We have the most intimate fellowship with Him and oneness with Him. We're so near to Him because of the oneness that we have with Him. To get it out of a religious framework and start living it out in the expression of fellowship that is revealed on the very countenance of our face and the expressions and the manner of our deeds and our conversation. And our confidence and our authority. Sickness can't stand around us. It can't exist around us. Look at how John G. Lake took a hold of it. What an expression. What a witness. Somebody stood up in the modern times and said, look, we really are the temple of the living God. Here, put plague on my hand. I'll show you to die when it touches me because I'm the temple of the Most High. Such an authority. Now is becoming more persecuted to have a radical disposition about miracles, signs and wonders, healing. You become like somebody who's a fundamentalist wacko, a biblical flake. It's all right. Just stand. God's word stands sure. His promises stand certain. You just stand there in that place, and you just let persecution come, because God will arise in your midst and everybody will be silenced.
Yes.
Everyone will be silenced.
Hallelujah.
What is it that you're going to allow to go on in your life? What is it that you're going to allow to go on in your family that is purely demonic? Measurably demonic. If it's manifest sin, it's measurably demonic. Then I'll take it and lower it. How much sickness and disease are you going to allow to go on? I'll even lower it. How many bad attitudes are you going to allow to go on? Are you listening to me over here? You decide how passionate you are going to be about executing the will of the Father. How passionate you're going to be about moving in the authority which God has given you to tread upon scorpions and serpents and over all the power of the enemy. To walk in the authority of his word where Satan cannot touch you. I write unto you young men, because you're strong and you have overcome the wicked one. To be able to defeat him at every point. I don't care if he shows up as a king or as a president or as a governor or as a senator or as a judge or who he is, what form he comes in. God has set his servants in a place of divine authority.
Yes.
And he upholds that authority if we're willing to walk in it, to where not one of our words fall to the ground. That's the kind of relationship Father wants us to have. Such a boldness of confidence that we know he's on our side, that he's with us, that he's walking with us, that he's defending us, that he's upholding us, that whatever we ask, he will do it. Oh, it's a relationship confidence that you come into when you begin to walk out the life of the obedient believer. It is a place that you want to have. It is a place that, I mean, my goodness, is beyond all that we could think or ask. And it should be something that you pursue more than any other interest in life. There should be nothing more valuable to you than having these things. Than having this kind of relationship. Jesus. Jesus. The Lord wants us to walk around giving thanks, not having all this other stuff, but having rather the continual of giving thanks, recognizing Father has given us these blessings and we're just giving him thanks for them. For this you know, that no immoral person, no one who lusts after the opposite sex. And even worse, God forbid, it's not even named the same sex, which is a whoremonger. Just always, I full of adultery, always just can't. Instead of making a covenant with your eye not to see, you're sneaking around and looking. There's a great emptiness in your life. There's a great void in your life, so Satan is able to come and fill the void. And now you don't know the joy and the ecstasy of his presence. The only thrill you get is to be involved in whoremongering. That's pretty pathetic. It's just too true. What Peter said, what Isaiah said, there's never a time where it's being fulfilled, having eyes full of adultery, they cannot cease from sin. The question that the Bible continually asks, have you ceased from sin? Now, all of a sudden, that's the Bible question, that's the Bible declaration, and now I'm the person who has false doctrine because I'm telling you that you're to cease from sin. I'm the guy who's the heretic. Because I'm declaring the word of God that says you are not to have sin in your life. No. They the heretic. They the one walking in heresy. They the liars. Because they're not speaking his word. They're stealing from God's people the knowledge of the holy. The knowledge of the Lord. The word of faith. The word of authority. When that's stolen from you, you have no power to stand against sin and iniquity. You run over. And you can say all you want. You're laying aside the weight and the sin which says so easily beset you, but you better get the job done before you die. And I've seen the people that are trying to lay it aside, they still basically in the same ditch they were in when I first saw them many years ago. In fact, they've taken on more weight. And they come into compromise and just basically said, you know, praise God for his mercy because we're all just sinners. No, that's the doctrine of the day. Praise God for his mercy. We secure in our sin. There can be nothing more damnable than that. I asked the Lord one time, I said, Lord, what's the difference between the doctrines of devils and the doctrines of men? And the Spirit of the Lord made known to me, the doctrines of devils will keep you out of heaven. And the doctrines of men will keep you from enjoying the blessings of heaven now. You hear me?
Yes.
I don't want either one of them. And if I'm not enjoying the blessings of men, then somewhere I have been compromised by the doctrines of men. You are listening to me. If I'm not realizing in my life the things that God has purposed in my life, there's some areas where I'm not faithfully doing the things which He's purposed me for to do. And I want to change. I'm here tonight saying to you, I want to change. I want to grow. I want to mature.
Yes.
I want Satan to have no access, no place in my life.
Yeah.
No influence in my life.
Amen.
I want Father to so fill me that everything that Jesus Himself would do if He were standing here tonight, He's free to do through me. That's what He's looking for. That's what He wants. And there is no way for us to change that and modernize that or mitigate it so we can feel better about ourselves. In fact, I'm not here to make you feel better about yourself. I'm here to tell you to flee from the wrath that is to come. I'm here to help you understand what God requires of you, what God requires of me. Because God requires the same of the one who delivers His word as those who hear His word. The abiding place of ministry is going to be a place to abide for people who love abiding.
Amen.
In Christ Jesus.
Amen.
Not just in the meeting, but on the Monday.
Yes.
And on the Tuesday and on the Wednesday and on the Thursday and on the Friday and every day. You're just not even happy. You just don't even belong unless you're flowing in the Holy Ghost, unless rivers are flowing out, unless there's tongues and interpretation, prophesying, going down the road. Hallelujah. See, just being built up in your most holy faith, letting the word of Christ dwell in you richly. Amen.
Yeah.
Speak, being filled with the Spirit and speaking to yourself. Amen.
Amen.
Hallelujah. Thank you, Jesus. God, the Holy Ghost turns people that are full of doubt, like Thomas, into people that are full of faith. He turns people who are full of fear into people who are full of boldness. Amen.
Amen.
He turns quiet people into loud people.
Amen.
Because He takes all the fear and the intimidation and the insecurity away.
Amen.
He fills you with the passion and the flow of heaven. Sutara masiki pradisht. Hallelujah. Sikambra basa devremeni. For this you know, that no whoremonger, nor unclean person. And I believe I just need to talk about unclean persons real quickly. Unclean persons, primarily, it was seen in any way in the Old Testament of people who defile themselves. There's a whole list of how you defile yourself. But it's primarily to defile yourself with sin. And it has a special emphasis on things like homosexuality. And other iniquity, messing around with dead bodies, just touching them even. There's a list. Reality of it is, in the New Testament, it's even heightened even more by the interaction with unclean spirits. And then we see different people that God, Christ Jesus, encountered who had unclean spirits. And He gave the disciples, His apostles, authority over unclean spirits to cast them out. And the reality of it is you could actually pare down unclean spirits to any kind of interaction with the demonic, which makes you unclean. Anything that is not holy, touching anything that is unholy, makes you unclean. But it has a special emphasis here, and it's lined up with sexual immorality, and so therefore we associate it with areas of sexual immorality like homosexuality. No whoremonger, no unclean person, no covetous men. You ever seen run around, see people just jealous? They're just jealous. They're envious. They're jealous because you got something that they don't have. Huh? People get greedy and stingy with things. It's just all about a covetousness. It's having possessions or wanting possessions, material things. You upset that somebody else has them and you don't have them, or you pursuing them at any cost, or you just want them, you got a lust for them. God calls it idolatry. He calls it the worship of other gods. Is it just me, or does this thing continually seem like it gets quieter and quieter, and then I got to bring it to my... Jesus. Where is the battlefront? How is Satan, by what means does Satan enter into the world? By bringing men under the authority of a demonic lie from his word, the things that he spoke. You hear me? Yes. And ultimately, it resulting in disobedience. And the same thing goes on in our life. Are we equipped? Are we fit? Do we understand our adversary, the devil? Do we understand the reality of that which we are up against? And the only way that we're going to meet the powers and the forces of hell is that we understand and know the terror of the Lord. Thus we persuade men that if Christ died for all, then all are dead. That we should henceforth no longer live for ourselves, but to him. And what does that look like? Huh? That looks like a new creation where old things are passed away and everything is new and everything is of God, walking around as his ambassadors with the ministry of his righteousness and his power of reconciliation, demanding the world to change.
Yes.
Hallelujah. And declaring the righteousness of God in word and deed. And having the authority of heaven in the midst of our life to recognize that we stand in his stead and his place. And I mean, goodness, when that begins to work in our life, then yes, whatever we bind on earth will be bound in heaven. Yes, whatever we loose on earth will be loosed in heaven. It's a powerful challenge to get a hold of a little spirit. A little human spirit that has been put in your charge. Huh? It's a powerful challenge to get a hold of your human spirit. Yours. You. And present yourself a living sacrifice, holy and acceptable unto God, which is your reasonable service. Which is that which God expects of you. And of course, the scripture says, nor covetous man who is an idolater. They don't have any inheritance in the kingdom of Christ and of God. People who practice these things, who live in them, which Paul said, don't let it be named once among you. In other words, that'd be once in 1,000, not once in you. Well, I just do it once a week. Oh, it just happens to me once a month. Not once among you. You say, well, that sounds like a miraculous, holy thing that God has done in people's lives when they become a new creation and old things pass away and everything becomes new and everything is of God. Absolutely. That sounds like a miracle kind of a life where you live and are led by the Holy Ghost and you walk in God and live in God, where you his temple, he's with you and in you. Exactly. That sounds like those people who are living by the word of God and don't live by any other word, who've come out from among them, been separate, and now the Father has received them and he's become our God and we become his people. The line between good and evil has been diffused. Some has been erased. The line between right and wrong has almost been erased. The line between righteousness and unrighteousness has almost been erased. His time had become clearly defined for everybody, and everyone know where they stand. Choose you this day whom you shall serve. Let no man deceive you with vain words, for because of these things comes the wrath of God upon the children of disobedience. Let nobody deceive you with vain words. Let nobody deceive you with empty lies, saying it's okay, God understands, we're all sinners, we're going to sin more or less every day. And of course, when they're talking about sin more or less every day, they're talking about in some degree or measure being involved in these things right here that were just listed. Do you hear me? Don't let anybody deceive you with vain words. Those who do these things that Paul said, do not let it be named once among you. With what greater emphasis can Paul make in a few verses of Scripture an emphasis that is made again and again and again throughout the Word of God that sin is not to be allowed in our life? This just focuses on don't do these things. It doesn't tell you all the consequences. It doesn't tell you all the repercussions. It doesn't tell you all the impacts. It just simply says the wrath of God comes upon the children of disobedience. The spirit of the disobedience that is at work in the world right now, that comes right out of the realms of the God of this world. The Lord has given us the spirit of obedience. That's the spirit. That's the spirit of sonship. Let me just read one other little passage of verse. Well, I just thought of Mark chapter 6. I was just going to go quickly over to 1 Corinthians chapter 3, but just go with me and let's look at what defiles a man. And I believe we would go over to Mark chapter 6 to look at this. In Mark chapter 7. In verse 21. Verse 20. He said, that which comes out of a man, that defiles a man. I understand this. Temptation is in the world. Temptation had its impact on the Lord Jesus Christ. Jesus was tempted. Everybody understand Jesus was tempted just like we're tempted, yeah. Right? Yeah. What does that mean? That means he had the thought of sin. Here's what people do. They say, do you used to even have the thought of sin is the same as sin. No, it isn't. Otherwise, Jesus would have sinned. Because you can't be tempted without the thought of sin. Hello. It's the ability by the authority that the Lord Jesus Christ has given us to stop that thing, to not allow it to develop, because it will develop. Once it develops, once it's conceived, it then becomes a heart problem. It becomes an inner man issue. And now it comes out of you. You hear me? All that is in the world, the lust of the flesh, the lust in the eye, that's all been cast out of us. It's not in us. There's not latent sin in us. There's not iniquity in us. It's all been removed. You know what we do have, though? We have the knowledge of good and evil. That makes things very, very different. So I said, well, we take back to Adam's time, and it's just as though, you know, everything has been restored right back to that place where Adam was before he sinned. No, he was innocent then. We've been restored completely, made a new creation. We've been created again in a new, renewed in righteousness and holiness. True holiness, we have the knowledge of good and evil. There's only one power that is able to deal with that in man, Holy Ghost.
Yes.
Holy Ghost. And having begun in the Holy Ghost, now we're perfected by the Holy Ghost, and that's what we've got to rely upon the Holy Ghost. That's what we've got to depend upon the Holy Ghost. That's what we've got to be led by the Holy Ghost. That's what we're born of the Holy Ghost. Hallelujah.
Hallelujah.
And we've got to understand that reliance that we have on him. But here Jesus is dealing with an unredeemed heart, but we're also at the same time, we're dealing with a person who conceives in their heart sin because they allow the thought, they allow the temptation, they allow the imagination to now become something that they themselves are going to participate in. And the Lord says, this, you're going to get defiled. You're going to become unclean. In other words, for from within, out of the heart of man, proceeds evil thoughts. Somebody says, see, the Lord, if I'm having an evil thought, and the Lord Jesus is dealing with unredeemed men, he says, see, if I have an evil thought, it shows that I've not been, that there's still the old man there. No, it doesn't show that there's the old man there. That's been removed. We have to understand the Word of God. He's given us a new heart. If we agree with the disobedient, the lies of Satan, the same word that came to Adam. See, Adam wasn't deceived. Eve was deceived. Adam was in the transgression. He knew what he was getting ready to do. God told him not to do it. And every man, every one of us are going to stand in that place this week, tomorrow, maybe even tonight. God said, do not do it. And we're going to decide whether we're going to be disobedient. If we're disobedient, what do? We open up a floodgate for Satan to come in. Satan has been cast out. All that he had, all the power that he had, all the authority, all the influence that he had over our lives was completely removed in the new birth. But that doesn't mean that people can't come into bondage again and become oppressed by evil spirits. And people become oppressed by evil spirits. And when you're oppressed by evil spirits, that power of darkness has authority over you and has the ability to block all that God himself would deliver to you. And you live under the tyranny of that. And it's manifested in different dimensions. It can be manifested in a continuance in that sin. And then it also has other repercussions. Other things are being stolen from you. You're missing out on the blessing of God in terms of every area of provision. Yeah. And it goes on. Why living in that mess? Why live in the filth and the pig pen of his prison? When God would come and set you free. The beautiful thing about the blood of Jesus Christ is his wonderful washing, redeeming, restoring power for the person who lays hold on the covenant, cries out to God, lifts up their voice. He responds. Comes and delivers us. What, did I just go fall back into it again?
No.
At some point in time, you're going to have to get yourself some godly sorrow. At some point in time, you're going to have your eyes open. At some point in time, before it's for eternally too late, you're going to have to cease from sin. You're going to have to lay hold upon the power of God that has been provided for you so that you can cease from sin. Out of the heart proceeds evil thoughts, adulteries, fornications, murders, thefts, covetousness, wickedness, deceit, lasciviousness, an evil eye, blasphemy, pride, foolishness. All these things come from within and defile the man. That's the unredeemed state. But what happens is this. All of these things are not eradicated in the sense that they don't exist with an influence that would come out against you because now they're in the world. That right there is summarized in the lust of the eye, the lust of the eye, the lust of the flesh, and the pride of life. That's what's in the world. The beautiful thing, this a great fortress that we have in God when we know that we've been redeemed and we've been made a new creation and old things are passed away and behold, all things are new. And he's given us a new heart and a new spirit. And he's come to live and dwell on the inside of us, to reign on the inside of us. That is such a liberation. That is such a high tower of defense now against all that is in the world. Well, the problem is people have laid hold, as it were, on a reason and an excuse for their disobedience. And they have left off the high tower of defense. They've left off this place of safety that they can run to where Satan can't access them. A place where Christ Jesus dwells in our heart. A place where the Holy Ghost dwells in our hearts. A place where His Word dwells. Hallelujah. Thank you, Jesus. But we have to recognize that these same things, although they do not exist in our heart anymore, can come and take back over a dominion in our house, in our heart, because they're still at work in the world. The spirit of disobedience is still there. It is now, we are at war with these things. These things come to try to forcefully impose themselves upon us by the demonic realm. And you and I just need to be hid away in the glory. So preoccupied with what's going on in heaven, we have no time for hell. Come on. I mean, who would not choose heaven over hell? If you stood at the crossroads and you said, well, you can go into heaven right now, or you can go into hell. You go into heaven and enjoy the joy and the pleasure of it, or you go into hell and suffer the torment of it. Everybody's going to go over heaven. In reality of it is you're standing there making the same decision with the choices of good versus evil, of obedience versus disobedience, continually. Whether you have the wisdom and the understanding enough to see it or not, every choice of disobedience is going to open up a floodgate of death and destruction. God will not be mocked. Anyone who sows to the flesh shall of the flesh reap corruption. The wages of sin is death. You literally are choosing hell. You're opening the door to everything that hates you and wants to destroy you to come rushing in. And the deception is so strong, they create a world of pleasure that you just seemingly can't live without. And the only way that they are effective in doing that is because your absence, because of the absence of the pleasures that are in His presence. The joy and the glory and the rejoicing that is an expression of this continual flow of the Spirit of the living God in you. Hallelujah. And we, that's why we come to the meeting, and that's why we begin to praise and worship. That's why there's the anointing of God in the house to touch you, to feel you, to cause you to hook up with the place that's down. You can live in continually.
Amen.
I'm going to read one more verse of scripture to you. You ready?
Yes.
Did you know that there is no power of darkness that can stand 1 second against the power and the authority of God? And the only way that Satan can have any place in your life is because you are unwilling to recognize who Jesus is and the gift that He has for you. You're unwilling to receive. You're in bondage, enslaved, oppressed, overrun by demonic forces that will not allow you to think God thoughts. They demand you to think demonic thoughts. And Jesus Christ is here to deliver you from it.
Hallelujah.
Completely set you free. All you have to do is come to Him. And that's at various different levels. Some places, some people are totally insane in padded cells. Some people are just overrun with it and they have what would be classified as mental disorders. Some people just live in it to where that they just have these thoughts that are continually on them and they just can't get rid of them. They're just constantly bombarding them, constantly filling their head. They don't know how to cast it down. They've never confronted them in the authority of Christ Jesus and brought them to an end. It is wonderful to come to a place of maturity where you decide every thought that is going to exist in your mind. You listen to me. This is the place of the believer. A maturity where you decide every thought that is going to exist in your mind. Because you've given yourself to growing and maturing in these things. That when these things come into your mind that are contrary to the Word of God, you recognize them right off and you say, no, in the name of Jesus, you will not think, I will not allow that thought. No, I put that thing to silence. No, in Jesus' name you go right now. God has given us the power to cancel it, to stop it, to, as it were, cast it out, to prevent it, to demand that it go. To where that then, where once a person was flooded with all kinds of thoughts contrary to the ways of God and the teachings of His Word, now his mind is continually occupied with the things that belong to the Spirit of the living God. That's the mind of Christ. That's the mind of the Spirit. Hallelujah. It's a mind filled with the Word of God, occupied with the dominion, those things which the Spirit of the Lord speaks. Because you've taken the authority, you begin to grow and mature in the weapons of your warfare, which are not carnal. You became strong in the Lord and the power of His might. Hallelujah. You no longer just a newborn baby. Hallelujah. Desiring the sincere milk of the Word. You a matured person. Hallelujah. Feasting on the meat of the Word. Praise God. Living in the Word by the Word. Hallelujah. Have received the engrafted Word of God. Living by it. Not just born by it, living by it. Amen. Just read this other verse of Scripture to me. I must be getting late. I can't tell. It's just everything's getting better. All the issues are being dealt with. You're being fit and equipped for the battle. You're being strengthened by the word of the Lord. You're having a good meal here tonight. Yeah, we are. I don't remember what day it was. I think it was Friday. I got up at 6 in the morning. Ann fixed me some breakfast, and then we just ran wide open. And sometime at around noon, I was passing by where she was at, and she was trying to give me some food, and I was in too big of a hurry, so I took the protein bar. Okay? And she had other things for me. Later on in the day, my mind was craving them. Where is that at? And I guess it was sometime around 7 o'clock, 7:30, because it's after dark. Having not had any food, having not had anything since breakfast, and having only that protein bar, and having worked wide open like we were doing, as soon as I walked in the house, I was completely exhausted. I was faint. I was completely out of energy. I had no more strength. Eat, dummy. Eat something. Huh? Eat the good word of God when you don't have any strength. I mean, have some food. Have some spiritual meat and drink. And went right to fixing some food. And I went in there, and mine was renewed in my strength. I was ready to get some more stuff done. Amen. It's just a reflection of the spiritual. You can't build something if you're lazy. You can't build something if you're waiting for everybody else to get the vision, because you ain't gonna happen. People will believe in what I'm doing now when it's reproduced in Asia again and again and again. They will believe in it. I must bear the cross of producing it. Because nobody else is going to get it. It's just the way it is. It isn't anybody's fault. It's a heavenly vision. It's declaring something that you got to be hearing from heaven to be able to even understand. It's the laying of the foundation and the preparation to be able to even do something. Huh? Where we have an MDC, which is part of the Abiding Place Ministry. It's not an asset. It doesn't own real property or real estate. It's a ministry. It's partnered with a private ownership. that is willing, that has offered the facility and partnered in the building of the infrastructure and the training program. Are you listening?
Yes. Yes.
You think you're going to train people in animal husbandry and you don't have any cows? You're funny. You're funny. What are you going to have cows? You're going to have a barn and provision and facilities. You're going to have fences mended. You're going to have a program for developing the food that they've got to eat and being able to understand how to teach that so that people in third world countries that don't have the same kind of nutritional inputs for the livestock that they would have know how to develop that. And you can't even get started yet. You see the foundation? You can't teach aquaculture until you have the means by which you can house the fish. And you got to understand how to take the eggs and you know, it's like someone said, you know, you hatch the eggs. Now, good luck in keeping them alive because you just got the easy part done. Look at all the work and all the labor and all the blocks that got to be laid and all the pipe that's got to be laid. I mean, I've laid almost, I think, close to a half a mile of pipe in the past 3 months. You understand? I'm talking about spiritual things. I'm talking about how you're going to move forward and the things that God wants to do with your life. I'm talking about you laying the foundation. I'm talking about you going to work. I'm talking about you having passion to see something happen that God has described about you that He wants to do through you. Hello.
Yeah.
You ain't gonna be lazy one moment and see the power of God and the things of God realized. There's not one person ever that has been lazy. You know what? You will not find me every year changing my mind doing something different. I've been doing what I'm doing right now for 34 years. I say the same thing over and over again. I'm saying the same thing this year that I said 5 years ago, that I said 3 years ago, that I said 2 years ago. It's just becoming more focused and more specific. That's all. I'm talking to you about where you're going to go with your life. I'm talking about you, whether or not you need somebody to agree with you, get on board with you and help you and understand you. Give me a break. Christ Jesus understands you. Holy Ghost will help you. It's like one person said, they wrote an email to me and said, I pray God give you the strength of 10 oxen. Well, fine, because I recognize that you're not going to give me 10 oxen and I'm not going to get any help from you, so praise God for that. I'll take that. I'll take it. Amen. Let me have the strength of 10 oxen. Amen. I didn't despise that. So, amen. I'll take all the help I can get in any way I can get it. Somebody said to me, he said, my goodness, I can't believe you went to school again for 2 years and it ended up being 2.5 years, almost 3 years, to get the degree in aquaculture. Well, I really didn't want to. I just looked around and I said, am I going to have anybody who's going to be willing to do this? No. Then I have to do it. And that's what you got to be willing to do. You have to be willing to go all in. You got to quit looking on somebody else. I have no man. You don't need a man when you got Jesus. When the water is troubled, I have no man to help me get my miracle. You don't need no man when you have Jesus. I'm just waiting for somebody to get behind my vision. Somebody said, pastors, they have churches. They want everybody to get behind their vision. Ha, ha. LOL. ROFL. LOL. RFOL. Exclamation mark, exclamation mark, exclamation mark. And if you don't know what ROOL, ROFL is, it's rolling on the floor laughing.
Jesus.
Just once you start laboring in the kingdom, you just start laboring in the kingdom, you get yourself a heavenly vision, you start getting passionate about the things the Father said He'd give you and that He'll do through you. I'm telling you right now, you'll be so filled with excitement. You'll be so filled with purpose, Satan won't have a chance.
That's right.
Huh? There's an old saying that says the idle mind is the devil's workshop. And that's, it's not the word of God, but it's close to a couple of verses of scripture in Proverbs. Huh? Get busy. Get busy in the things of the kingdom. If you're not doing a bunch of things around here, you need to start. Somebody needs to just go out there and wipe the sign off up a little bit. Clean the sign up a little bit. The other day, it had trash piled around it and limbs. Huh? Thanks, Mike. And whoever else went out and just saw it, because I'm like going by. I'm not going to stop and do it. I'm not going to do it. I see it. I'm not doing it. I'm not doing it. There's at least 40 people gone by the sign. If they don't have vision to do it, then I'm just going to enjoy this filth with them. You know what I'm saying? This sloppiness, this uncaring attitude, this willingness to just let it go, let it be a mess. No, you know what passion does? It constantly wants, it pursues better. The world calls it continuous improvement. Okay, it's fine right now, it's up and going. That sign out there was fine for the first week. After the first week, I'm like, well, now what is it now? What are people gonna do? Everybody's happy with that? You happy with that? That's what you believe. That's where your interest is. That's how you're vesting in the kingdom of God. Pastors have a church so they can gather everybody around their vision. R-O-F-L. Rolling on the floor laughing. It's about getting people interested in the heavenly vision. And that's hard enough. Hello. And we appreciate everything that people are doing. But I heard the Spirit of the Lord say this morning to me, people need to be... You need to encourage people to become more involved in the things of the kingdom so that they can find a way to live out the heavenly vision that results in the intimacy and the dependency in relationship with the Lord that cannot be in any other way realized. Yeah, you can have a personal relationship with the Lord of just loving Him and being blessed by Him and knowing that He's with you, but there's a threshold on that. When you're not willing to love Him enough to be a part of what He wants and a part of what He's doing and making His stuff the best stuff. I mean, that sign out there could look like something, you know, downtown New York right now. You know what I'm saying? It could have like lights and just rolling things and be all kinds of beautiful thing. And I mean, it wouldn't cost more than $1,000. I'm leaving it alone. And it costs this and that if you do the work. Are you listening to me?
Yes.
Hello. And so what I do is I'm like, there's faith and there's presumption. I just say, okay, Father, there's all these things that we need to get done. Now, somebody said, oh, you just stand there and just believe for the finances to come in. Well, that's fine. I'm going to believe in God for the finances to come in. I know how to believe God for the finances to come in. Okay, there's no finances there? Okay, I'll do the work. I'm not going to be stopped. Are you going to be stopped? You can set things up. Well, when this happens, then I'll do it. No, no, no. Do it. Are you listening to me? Do it. And when you start, don't you stop. Don't you set your hand to the plow and look back, because you're not worthy if you do. That's what Jesus said. He's radical. Say, I'm going to do it, and you don't do it. And people get into things all the time. Oh, I'm going to be a part of this. And then they get in there and they find out the load of work. And it's like, whoa, this is a lot of work. I'm going home. I want to do something else. Is there something else that I can do? I decided I didn't want it to be in the media anymore. I'd like to be in the music ministry. And then all of a sudden somebody says, well, you know what? If you're going to be in the music ministry, you need to really improve yourself a little bit here. You need to give yourself to the music. Well, that's work now again. Now we're back into work. Ah, well, let's see. What can I do now? You're going to have to go through it. You go through it for your own interest. You labor for your own interest. One day it'll be weighed in a balance before you at the judgment seat of how you passionately pursued your own interest and the things for yourself versus how you passionately pursued the interest of the kingdom of God. It'll be weighed in a balance. I know this for truth. One day the Lord spoke to me, as many years ago, and we stepped out in faith, you know, to get a house The Lord led us to it. It's a great, great miraculous story. We came back from being out on our honeymoon and just waiting on the Lord as to where the Lord was going to lead us and what he was going to do with some ministry. And the Lord woke me up one Sunday morning and said, go back to San Diego. And I'm going to fulfill the things that I've purposed you to do there. I mean, it's just a radical word from heaven. It's a beautiful thing. And usually when I talk about it, I just, you know, if I'm not careful, I say the wrong things. I'll just have a breakdown. I'll go right back to the moment because it was such an intense thing in the Lord. But so we got here and they, HybridTech, I mean, you know, I started working with a company that offered me $16,000 a year. I mean, this is like slave labor. I mean, I was making that when I was 15 years old. And now I've gone through college and I said, okay, well, just take it. It's a job. Just take it. And so then we now got to get it. Now we got to get a house and we got to get a church. Okay? So I have it all figured out. I'm going to get a house big enough to have the church in the living room. And then I'm going to rent rooms out. And we just married. My blessed wife. So one day after doing this for about a year, Spirit of the Lord told me, said, get up, I'm going to give you a house. And so I did, I obeyed God. We drove down a road we'd never driven before. We went up 15, Poway Road, never drove that road. Went up 67, never drove that road. Just being led by the Lord. See some beautiful oak trees and a crazy mailbox sticking about 20 feet in the air. I said, that's weird. This is wild. This looks cool. Turn here. Then go down the road just a little bit, and we're on this road called Whirlwind Lane. That's wild. And then I'm parked right in front of this big open field that I thought was just absolutely amazing. And I say, wow, Lord, is that what you're going to give us? And then I turn to my right, and I immediately see house for sale. That's it. Just drove right there, parked right there. And the Lord gave us this house. And the Lord spoke to me not too long. I mean, it must have been 3-4 years, something like that afterwards. And he said, don't forget how passionate you were to obey me in that which I was going to give you. Now obey me in those things which are purely for me. This way it was being weighed in the balance. And I said, okay, Lord, I mean, we'll do it. We'll go with total abandonment. We'll be just excited about it. I was drawn in. It's going to be for me. I'm excited. We're just going to be led. We're going on a drive. We're excited. We're going house hunting. We didn't look in the paper. We didn't look where everybody else looks. Hot pad and Craigslist. I don't even know if it existed in that day. Probably didn't. We didn't. Because it was still Mac 210. Computers were brand new, as it were. Right? Pretty much. What, right, baby? Was that 1985 or 1986? 1986. Thank you, Father. Get yourself so wrapped up in the things of the kingdom of God. You don't have time for anything else, please. Make your whole life about the kingdom of God. We walked into HybridTech. I walked in with my stickers. What should it profit a man if he gained the whole world and loses his own soul? The blood of Jesus Christ cleanses from all sin. I put those stickers, had Randy make them for me. I put those stickers up on my lab bench, up in the high places where everybody said, could see them, people go by, said, you're not allowed to have that. I said, I am allowed. I have permission. You do? Yeah. And they didn't ask me from where I got permission.
Yeah!
I live for Jesus. People have these crazy calendars that have women that weren't dressed properly, I'd go to my desktop and I'd make dresses for them and I'd go pin up and take dresses on them. And they're like, who did this? Hey, I did that, man. Why did you do that? I'd say, because you're not allowed to have that in the office. You're not allowed to have counters like that. Who said? The person in charge. And the beautiful thing is people got to where they just left it on there, just left the dresses. They knew who did it. They left the dresses. It was fine. Next month, you know, new dress. And my signs got more radical. My cubicle got more displayed with various different things. And you could do that. And then they said, well, you know, the big bosses from Eli Lilly are going to come in, and there can't be anything that everything has to be neutral. And, you know, you're going to get in serious trouble if you leave all of this stuff up. I said, no, 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 man. I'm going to be fine. Uncle Eli was a man of God. They all walked by. They made people take down their calendars that I put dresses on. They made people take down their offensive stuff. My stuff was fine. It was left alone, hands off. Amen. I'm just going to make everything that I'm doing about the kingdom of God an opportunity to show the difference between life and death, good and evil. I'm going to preach. I'm going to preach about flee from the wrath that is to come. Because I'm going to preach about it loud. You're not going to come to this church and go to hell not knowing why you're there. Every sermon I ever preach, you'll find out you actually had a photographic memory and didn't even know it. They will all come back to you verbatim, word for word. It's all stored right now in your thinking and your thoughts. Whether you have the ability for clear thinking or not at this moment in time, there will be a time you'll be liberated from all the things that harass you and burden you. And you'll see and discover every word was captured. Every word. I pray that you'll let every word of God become effective in your life. God's word is powerful. It's living. It will produce its fruit in you. It will keep you. It will be a buckler and a shield for you. It'll be a defense for you. It'll be a sword for you. I pray that you be so captivated with the relationship that you have with the Lord. Suddenly you recognize that you're in charge. And then anything that looks like it's demonic, you have complete authority over it to stop it, especially as it affects you personally and as that which you have power over. Right now, I can't stop what's going on in the nation. I'm reaching for that anointing. I want to understand that realm. But I can stop anything that's going on in my life, and that's where it's got to start. I can stop and shut down anything that Satan's trying to do in my family. That's where it starts. I can stop and shut down anything that's going on in this church that's not of God, because I'm going to get after it. I'm not going to turn a blind eye to an open vision. You hear me?
Yes.
There was a time in my life. I just want to say this. I'm about to close. I just want you to understand the dynamics of what we deal with. There was a time in this church where there were so many people in the midst of the church making accusations against me and against the call of God upon our life and where we were taking the church. People did not want to obey. They did not want to listen. They were being stubborn. And I mean, it was such a demonic force that I had to deal with. Only a few people really understood it and understood what was going on, the intensity of what we were having to deal with. I mean, it was such a thick, oppressive thing that it would make me almost gag. It would almost try to shove the words back down my mouth. You know what I did? I stayed with it till everybody who didn't want to change left.
Amen. Yes.
And they think that they left because they decided. No, no. God decided. There's been only about two people or three people in my life that I told that they had to leave the ministry. They had to leave. They had to repent or leave. The rest of the Lord all sorted it out. I mean, I don't want to tell those people to do it, but the Lord said, it's just too much leaven. It's just, you're going to deal with it. You know, I just leave things alone until the Lord says so. I mean, the Lord just pushes me into it. And then he says it. I mean, it's judgment. My biggest concern, those people still haven't repented. I don't believe they'll make heaven. You have to repent. God will forgive you as many times as you need, but you got to repent. You have to turn from your sin. You got to acknowledge your sin and your wickedness, and you got to repent. You can't come under that kind of judgment to where you're told to repent or leave a church. And then you never repent of it? And you're saying you're right with God and you go to heaven? That's nonsense. Huh? It's like somebody said, you speak in tongues, but you lie in English? You know what?
That's Jesus. That's right.
You know, why do you, what's up with that? I mean, there's a fellowship with God. there's a fellowship with God and with His presence, manifest presence, that is the floodlight of heaven. Can you hear me?
Yes.
To wear that, you are under such an awesome awareness of His presence. You're under such a glory cloud of heaven that there is such a Holy Ghost conviction there. You would not lie. You wouldn't. You're aware of any kind of evil speaking. You're intensely aware of it. The judgment of it. Huh? You see what I'm saying? The offense of it. You just wouldn't do it. And isn't it wonderful, though, how we are rested by His love and by His joy to where it really isn't something that you're even going to drift that far to do something like that. I mean, you got to drift far into darkness to be again to speak evil of other people. You've got to drift far away from the Lord, far away from His presence to begin to live in these things of foolish talking and jesting and strife and envy and rebellion. You got to drift far from His presence, because just living with Him, you're just so filled with love and joy and just blessing and just so blessed and so happy, and you just want everybody else to be blessed and happy and hallelujah, kind of everything is going good. Even when you run as hard as we do. I mean, we run hard. Last week I think we kicked off the week going from, what was it, maybe 6 o'clock in the morning till 11. No, it's 12 at night when we finally, we ate it. Did we eat at 12, 11:30? Mom's making supper for us. But we happy. And we woke up happy. And we woke up blessed because we're pursuing those things which God has given us to do. It's fully consuming our life. And we don't even get paid. We pay to do it. We go and pay to preach. We pay. We don't go to get paid. We pay to do it. We pay to do the work. And we're happy. Isn't it wonderful?
Yes.
Amen.
Amen.
And Father takes care of us. He provides for us food we need. Amen.
Amen.
Hallelujah.
Hallelujah.
And the raiment, the coat was beautiful at one point in time. Now it's starting to get a little tattered. That's just earthly things. I got a coat that's much more beautiful than this. Yeah. It's made by my Father, and I want to show it off a whole lot more. I want to be a full witness to the things that He has made provision for us to have. I want to be a person who shows the world what it really truly means to be alive in God through Christ Jesus. What it means to be filled with the Holy Ghost. To walk in heavenly places. To have rivers of living water flowing out of us. To have a relationship that whatever I ask, Father will do it. And I tell you right now, there's a lot of things going on in the things of the Spirit. And a lot of things going on in our life. To give witness to that. And we're excited about it. The boldness and the confidence that comes out of it. And I know that any kind of sin, I know that any kind of disobedience literally will shut that down. It hampers it. It hinders it to some degree or some measure. And I'm not having nothing to do with that. I'm speeding up, not slowing down.
Amen.
I'm looking for something far greater than anything that's in this earth. Much less than is in hell. And the distinction has been made for me, and I want to make it for you by the same anointing that revealed it to me.
Amen.
I want to impart these things to you. Everybody, would you just stand up with me? Amen.
Amen.
Stand together with me. Hallelujah. I'm so blessed to see the atmosphere change. Sometimes the atmosphere changes by when people leave. And we've had a bit of that. You know, there's some people that come into the meeting, and I'm constantly under the pressure of stopping. I can feel it. They didn't realize it, that they are creating a demand They're creating, they're bringing something to the meeting, and it ain't what God purposed. What they're bringing to the meeting is it over yet? How much longer must we endure this? We're used to 45 minutes, so now we're at 2 hours and 45 minutes. Those people don't usually last that long. They usually last an hour and a half. They go double. These things the Spirit of the Lord wants you to bring. So kando resonge limon shambrukaste tora dipitis. Thank you so much, Crystal. She's back there playing so quietly, I can't even hear her. Bless her heart. You know, I thought at one point to tell you that it's good, come and sit down. And the Spirit of the Lord said, just let her stand there. She's entering in more. It's just something. I mean, if we could give all of you a keyboard, if that would make a difference. Might be a bit hard to preach over top of that. Thank you, Lord Jesus. Dear people, we just want to say this. We're very thankful. We're very thankful for you standing with us in what God has done here. What God has done here is just, if it isn't miraculous for you to see, let me just go ahead and tell you, this is miraculous. And the world knows about it. I mean, people talk about it all over the place. It is amazing. You just don't understand how far away people talk about the Abiding Place ministry. And it's such a blessing. The Lord creates a rumor. He just does that. He just likes to do that kind of stuff. He creates a rumor. And let me just tell you, let me just tell you what happened the other day. The other day, Ann and I got in the car to go to the Klamath County Planning Department to lay out the things that we wanted to do. And we were just praying, thanking the Holy Ghost that He is in charge, and just thanking Him for His favor, and just walking, and it's just thinking that we can walk in His love and His peace and not get over into our processes of thinking. Because I discovered my process of thinking and the way that I would respond to things messes everything up. My brilliance destroys the whole works. And so, having learned this lesson by many opportunities, I finally got to the place, you know, where I just let God be God, you know. So I walked in and I said, well, these are the things that we want to do. And the lady looks at me and she goes, well, there's no way that you're going to get this done over the counter. I said, well, that's fine. That's no problem. And I'm just filling out the stuff that I needed to do. And she comes back and she says, she got everything all put together. 10, 15 minutes later, it's all done deal. She just got it. It's like God be God. I didn't get in. That's fine, no matter what. No problem. I stayed in the peace, you see. Right. I didn't say, well, you know, this is the United States of America. Why do you say I heard about you socialism. Okay. Stay over here in the ground of this peace. Right. And so I said to her, I said, now, I know that I've already put a big one on you, and I so much appreciate your willingness to put all this together. I got everything done in less than 15 minutes that could have taken, that I thought was going to take 2 to 3 months to go through all kinds of various different conditional use permits and whatnot. I said, now, I got another thing I want to lay on you. I said, I want to do a meeting hall. And I said, I'm going to tell you right up. I said, it's a church, but I just don't want to call it a church because I don't want to offend you. I said, in California, they would make me do 100 times more than what it would make me do. You know, I basically framing it up similar to that, and then you use those exact words. She said, listen, I have no problem with the church. I said, you don't? I said, that's beautiful. And she said, let's call it a church. I said, okay. I said, what all do I got to do? She looked at me. She stood there and looked at me. She said, nothing. You know what she told me? She said, draw on a piece of paper where the parking lot is going to be, where the building is going to be, where the access is going to be, and where the septic system is going to be. Ha! I didn't start shouting until I got out of the building. I tried to act like I'm calm. So we got permission for the Glory Barn Full Gospel Church there in Bly, Oregon. And, you know, Daniel and I went out and dedicated it. It's on the Paradise Road. It's on a corner piece of property that we own. Hallelujah.
Hallelujah.
And usually they would make you do a subdivision, do a parcel out the land, do a conditional use permit. It would be a process that you would go through that then would have to do a community questionnaire. It goes on and on. Just approval over the counter. And it's just so beautiful because I see something so glorious in what God's going to do with that building. So what we're going to begin to do is this. We have two amazing, highly qualified leaders from Nepal. Many of you met Bal Krishna Sharma, who was my interpreter in the Crusades in 2006 and also in 2008, and who is one of the premier leaders in the Assemblies of God Church in Nepal. He's the president of the Bible School and Assembly of God Seminary. He's a graduate of Oxford. His oldest son and wife want to come and are passionate about coming, and Jeremy Graham's been helping me work getting our permission from the government to grant student visas, and they're dedicating themselves to 3 years being the leaders of the Mission Training Center for all the Nepalese to come in. And so we don't have a house built for them. And somebody said, how about the Mouse House? The Mouse House will be torn down. It was supposed to have been torn down already 2 years ago. I'm not letting that infested thing stand. It does not represent us. You hear me? You understand that? And we're blessed that Pastor Brad and Margaret were willing to live in that thing. And it would take Brad's continual warfare against the army of mice, which Jason can be a witness and a testimony. It's tough to go for a bowl of cereal and a mouse pops up out of the thing, because the infestation is just too crazy. I mean, that's a little bit, probably a little much, but not too far off. You know, it's to be greeted by a whole family of mice sitting at the table in the morning and running across the bed at night. We're tearing that down. We've already got permission to tear it down. We're going to start raising funds specifically for things like building a house and putting pictures up of Kiran and his wife, who are coming from Nepal, so everybody can see them, come to understand who they are. We've been working now for what, Jeremy? 4 months, continual back and forth with the government, also with them. We were hoping to have them in by September, and we just haven't gotten the permission. And plus we were going to just have to put them in a makeshift place, but we want to build the facility that is going to be for that kind of leadership role. And so we're going to raise funds for that. And we want you guys to come up with creative ways to participate with that, because we want to put up a steel structure, and the steel structure is going to cost us right about $30,000. And that's just the shell. Now we still got to build out the rooms. And we've basically started a partnership with a construction company called Solid Rock Construction. Can't go wrong with a Solid Rock. And they committed to us to, you know, for supplying the materials, they're going to do the work for $10,000 a month, which is not a bad deal. And so we figured for them to build that out, it will only take them, the design that we have, simple design that we have, it's only going to take us about 1 month, about $10,000. and probably right around $30,000 in materials. So we're laying out a house that we're going to build for the leadership for about $70,000. We're also going to be raising the funds for the church. And, you know, what we're willing to do, and what, because this is the way we do it, we just go with it. And so maybe we only have the shell. We just tell the family, well, we got the shell. You got a bathroom and a big room, you know? And, you know, and we'll get this thing done. And if that's the way we got to do it, well, fine. But if you'll hook up with me in faith, if you'll get into agreement with this, I want the confusion to come to an end. Many of you got a text from me, an email from me today, because I just still sense some confusion about what the MTC is. The MTC is a ministry. It's not a real estate holding company. It is not an asset of a real estate property or any other form of property. It is a ministry. Hello. And a private ownership has partnered with the ministry to give all the resources to be able to do the thing, because you can't do it in the parking lot out here. Does that make sense?
Yeah.
You can't do animal husbandry out here in the parking lot. Hello. Or in, you know, on 5 acres of or 10 acres or 50 acres. You're just not going to get it done. And all the things that we're doing. So we have a private ownership who has a lifetime partnership with MTC / Abiding Place to see this vision move forward. Do you understand that?
Yes.
I want you to understand that it's like giving an offering. And that when somebody says, well, who owns the building then that we build for the leaders? The private ownership owns it. Hello? Got a problem with that? And guess what that house is going to be doing for the rest of your lifetime and for your children's lifetime? It's going to continue with the vision. And so I got to get rid of this greedy concept and small-minded thinkingness that goes on with people. Who owns it? What, you want to own it? You know what I'm saying? I'm telling you right now, I just challenge people. Listen, you come up with a similar vision and you tell me how you would do it. You tell me how you're going to come up with the $2.5 million to buy the property in the first place. Then you tell me how you're going to come up with the human resources and raise up the leaders to do all the stuff, to create the training program, and tell me what kind of budget you got for that, because that's going to be about $500,000 a year. And then we just getting started here. Hello. So once you thought it through, I believe you'll begin to say, wow, God has really worked a miracle here. I'm really happy about this. My friend Phil Smithhurst, what they do at Overland's Mission is this. They invite leaders to come live on the property, and they tell them, you build a house on the property, you live in it. When you're ready to go, the house is ours. You can take the furniture. And everybody's happy with that. And they should be happy with that. Why? Because they're sowing into the ministry. Hallelujah. Well, who owns it? A private ownership owns it. What's the problem? They love God. They got the vision. They doing the thing. Hello. What do you want, a 501(c) to own it? Huh? Are you listening to me? I think we were wondering, how many things can I do without asking permission? Nothing. You hear what I'm saying to you? I want everybody to clearly understand this. I want you to be comfortable with it. We're going to build a church. Who owns the building? The private ownership owns the building. What are they going to do with it? They're going to be having church when you in heaven. They're going to be having church so the Lord Terry is coming when your grandchildren are walking around. Hello. Hallelujah. Habakashaya Poranaya. Because the private ownership sold out to Jesus. The private ownership, everything they have belongs to the living God. Hallelujah. But the private ownership is going to keep anybody from moving in and touching it that shouldn't be touching it. Hallelujah again.
Hallelujah.
And furthermore, in the third world nations like Nepal, a church can't own nothing. It has to be owned by a private ownership. It has to be owned by an individual or a corporation. Church can't own anything in these third world countries. Do you understand? We are creating a model that is going to be reproduced in Kashmir and Nepal and other places. That's why we have buildings that have absolutely no electricity going to them. Everything has to be done completely off the grid. You got to learn to do it a new way when you're working with me. And I may come out and I may say things to you that boggle your mind because it is not the way they showed it on the YouTube. But guess what? I don't have to look at the YouTube. I've got this creative thinking thing going on that works. We right now have over 60 PSI. That's more than you have a pounds per square inch of water pressure coming in to the greenhouse, and we don't have any pumps or any electricity. Hallelujah. And with that, I can do all kinds of really cool tricks. From recycling, recirculating systems. Come on, think about what you can do with 60 PSI of water pressure. And it doesn't cost anything. And I can do it in any third world country on the planet and produce the same kind of things without any need for any electricity. Hallelujah. And furthermore, we've done some other things that are really exciting I'm not going to tell anybody about right now. You'll have to come and see them sometime. And because I just don't want to broadcast it. Hallelujah. But see what happened is through the process, we're going to get all kinds of discoveries out of it. And you know what discovery is? It's doing something the way that nobody else thought how to do it. Hello. And so if you come and I start saying we're going to do X, Y, and Z, you're going to go, how are you going to do that? Just do it. Just do it. Watch. We're going to do it because God's going to give us the ability to do things uniquely. And so we've been sharing these things with other scientists. Listen to this. We needed a veterinarian. We needed somebody who really understood all these things that we were learning. And the Lord just set it up. We just had this miracle week, one thing after another. The Lord set it up, and we meet this guy, and he's a young guy. He's a veterinarian, recently from a prestigious veterinarian school. And he comes out, and he helps us doing all of our stuff, a very elegant unique techniques that very few people know, and he knows it inside and out, trained by a team out of Morocco, in Morocco. Gets so excited about what we're doing. I said, okay, so after it was all over, I said, how much do I owe you? He said, absolutely nothing. His cousin is with him. His grandfather is a preacher from New Mexico. He says, I want to come and just help you work. He said, I don't want any money. I just want to come and help you work. I said, what kind of work do you do? He said, well, I've been doing ranch work all my life. I can mend fences. I can brand cattle. I said, how much do you want to be paid now? No, I just want to come. I'm going to pay you. And so the bottom line of it is we have a partnership with a veterinarian guy who knows about all very unique techniques of the things that God has given us. Because one of the reasons these types of programs, sustainable programs, and sustainable is a word that is very important. If you want to understand what we're doing, you got to understand sustainable. And the reason they've not been able to do sustainable food supplies is because they have not understood how to manage the genetics. What we're doing is full control over all the genetics because we're doing everything by way of eggs or embryos. So we supply eggs. We don't supply a bunch of fish and brood stock that they've got to manage. And then ultimately, what happens, inbreeding coefficient goes up, so does disease go up, and everything belly ups. You see what I'm saying? So we control it, whether it's fish or fowl or beast. We control it by transporting eggs. And we've got relationships that are set up that are so unique with University of St. Andrews, which is the most influential university in all of Asia. And that's where I got my degree. And as a result of the things that I did with them, the guys who lead the marine biology and fisheries program said, we're your consultants for life, man. We'll help you in anything you're doing. Just almost everybody we're meeting, they're saying, we will help you. We're in this. And just like this guy, his name's Dakota from New Mexico. Hallelujah. We're just in this with you. We want to do this with you. Come on. So it won't be long and we'll have we'll be able to we'll see him totally transformed, changed by the power of God. So we're already on that. We've already ministered to him. First day out, we've ministered to him. See him changed by the power of God, filled with the Holy Ghost. He's already just a really good guy with people praying for him. I can see it all over him, okay? And then we got somebody who's running the animal husbandry program with all the skills and qualifications therewith. And it's just the Lord's just organizing this. I mean, Karen, Brother Ball's oldest son, just wrote me an email yesterday. He said, we are just so excited and so believe in what God's given you to do. We can't wait to get there. We can't wait to begin to learn these things. We're all in. We cannot wait to take all of our network and bring it with us and bring it to bear. See, God stirs up people's hearts when it's him. And I want you to understand this. But one of the things is I felt that there's been a spirit of confusion running around. And I felt it today. I said something and I felt it. I said, wait a minute. What is that stinking thing running in the atmosphere? And then, you know, one of the best ways to deal with it is just to get real plain. You know, and to say very, very clearly. And you know, we have these things up on the website. We have two websites with these things on them. And maybe you don't know where to go to the website. It's called www.abidingplace.org. And you can find it all right there. And I went ahead and published it on my Facebook. But I'm going to do whatever it takes. We'll do whatever it takes. Because we want agreement. Agreement is going to move us forward. Any kind of disagreement, any kind of confusion, any kind of strife literally blocks. It creates a hindrance. It's just like I was saying in the days of Daniel, the prince of Persia stopped the blessing of God. Unique situation, unique circumstances, but it has application. When we don't get together on the same page, when people just thinking out of their brainy brain, the human mentality, if you've got something that is important to consider in the matter, bring it to the table. We want to hear wisdom, but we want you to agree with what God has shown us to do. There's always areas for improvement. There's no question about that. There's always areas to be able to maybe do things more efficiently. Please, I want to know it because I'm about wearing myself out over here, okay? I'm running with this thing. You don't see me standing here pointing and say, you go do this, you go do that, and I'll have my coffee and you can find me over in the office. Are you with me?
Yes.
If I can just get everybody together with me, I get you all together on the same page with me. I've told you about how this thing happened. We had this property that the Lord blessed us with through a series of just miraculous events, the things that the Lord himself set up. God did it. There's no way that man did it. God did it, okay? And then I was coming back from Yanji, China, and the Lord spoke to my heart to start a mission training center. Do you remember me telling you this story? Okay, I've told this story many times, okay? I'm just going to tell it again, because if you could look at the evolution of how it came down, it helps you understand more of the process. So the church didn't have to go and spend $2.5 million to buy the property. Didn't happen that way. It didn't happen that way at all. Okay? Do you understand? Does everybody understand? I want everybody to understand this. It was another way that things took place. And now, you know, the person that was partner with me in it, I said, this is what the Lord wants to do. And he's like, I'm all in, do it. And, now Father's setting things up where we're able to, you know, we're working right now to refinance things. We've made opportunities for people to come in and purchase some of the property on the north side, which we're going to sell to reduce the overhead, reduce the debt. We're totally refinancing it in such a way that makes it much easier for us to be able to present to people who might want to become a partner, where that they can clearly understand. Number one, it's one ownership. And that one ownership is in this thing for life. It is a ministry, it's a family, and they in this thing for life. They the one who birthed the vision, and they own it, kind of thing. You with me? And then, because we were talking about potentially maybe having various different fundraising things, and we want to make it very simple for people to understand very clear, no misrepresentation, no confusion in any way, to simply say, this is the way we're doing it. Do you want to become a part of it? Ultimately, what we want to be able to do is we want to be able, how are we going to, let me just give you an example. How do you reckon we're going to buy the property in Nepal to do the mission training center in Nepal? Because property in Nepal is just as expensive as property in Southern California. Because it's a very small landmass. And the people are very poor, but the people in India are very rich, and the people in China are very rich, and they're coming over and buying Nepal, Nepal. Okay? How are you going to buy that? How are you going to pay another $2.5 million? Well, what? Well, you can either try to raise it through offerings, or you can create it. You can create a business model, which is a sustainable business model that produces finances, that then you can take those finances and you can go and you can build the next one and you can hopscotch it. Who owns it? A private ownership owns it. Hallelujah. So, who is the private ownership? Someone sold out to the kingdom of God, who by word and deed has lived their life in pursuit of those things that the master commands. Come on. You start running with the program and you start stepping up and you start doing some stuff, okay? And then bring to the table the insights that God has given you. You listen to me now because I'm talking to you. Don't you let the enemy play tricky mind games with you. You live by the word of God and get out of your imaginations. You understand there's no way for you to isolate human thoughts distinctly from demonic thoughts. You got to understand the only thing that you and I can do to clean escape all that mess is live by the word of God. Do it God's way. Amen. Believe it. Grab a hold of things. Somebody said, how do you know that you can trust me? Well, you don't. If you ask them the question, you don't. Yep. Hallelujah. You hear what I'm telling you? Yeah. Amen. Amen. But, you know, the thing about it is, I believe the majority of the people in this place would never even ask that question. Anyways, I'm just putting it out there. Huh?
I wouldn't ask the question.
Think about it is, dear people, is the Lord's called us to go into all the world and preach the gospel. We're going to have to find out ways to do it.
Yeah.
And it's, you know, it's easy enough. Look at the majority of people. The majority of people in ministry go around and have an evangelistic, as it were, circuit. And everybody's going around this big circuit in the reached people groups. There's very few people going into Nepal. There's very few people going into Bhutan. There's very few people going into Kashmir. There's very few people going into Sikkim in Bangladesh. There's very few people, I mean, overall. And so, but that's where our heart's at. There's very few people in Tajikistan. Very few people. Well, even in Azerbaijan. And think about this. Azerbaijan, however you want to say it. Azerbaijan is the most wealthiest country in the world. Per capita. And they would love for us to come and do what we're doing. And it would be great if I had the human resources. If I had the human resources right now and the financial resources right now, there are several I would like to do simultaneously 10 nations right now, Azerbaijan being one of them. They'd be happy. North Korea, happy to have this. They would just open up the doors. Kashmir, happy to have this. And there's no way to get into Kashmir. There is no way to, listen to me. You got a better idea, I want to hear it. There's no way to get into Kashmir. The Saudis would love to have what we're going to be doing with bovine embryo transfer and development of the genetics in various different breeds of cattle. Telling you. And we utilize that as the means to start ministering to the orphans, start ministering to the old people, start ministering to the nation
into their economy, into their agricultural program to help their people, and becomes a road, an open door to preach the gospel. And I just say this, Kashmir was one of the big reasons that I moved into to include aquaculture, because the nation, we can go into the nation with aquaculture. We can go and stand at the veil of Kashmir. My goodness gracious. Do you understand the impact of that? Would you study a little bit? Would you just read a little research? Just understand how unreached and how unreachable Kashmir is, and the place that we could stand where radical Hinduism faces off with radical Islam, and they hate each other, but they're hating somebody else even worse, me, Christians. But now we can go in and bless the old people and bless the orphans and bless their economy. Hallelujah.
Hallelujah.
And you don't go in and set it up there and mess up, because then you fail big. You create a model. You do it. You do it right. You will. You completely define it. And then you go do it and you succeed. Hallelujah.
Amen.
And so that's what we've got to do. And you've got to think through the practical application and labor to do these things and do them right. And I just hope that everybody can see it. Watch out. There are people who left this ministry. If you listening to the counsel of the ungodly, you're not going to be blessed. Your head's going to be filled with information that you're not going to be able to process and deal with. And that's just the way it is. Blessed is the man who does not walk in the counsel of ungodly, nor stand in the way of sinners. I know some people who left here because they came and they asked me a question. I simply said, oh, I'm not telling you. It's none of your business. And they were offended. They should have been submitted. Because what they asked me was none of their business. Amen. Legends in their own mind. They just so built up in their own thinking that they think that their perceptions and their ideas and their judgments superior to everybody else. And then look at how they're living. You want to live like they live? You want to have the relationship with God that they have?
No.
I mean, my goodness gracious, then don't listen to what they got to say. Because it's their ideas that got them in the mess they're in. And if you buy into their ideas, it's going to get you in a similar mess. Are you hearing me? Buy into God's ideas and get blessed.
Yes.
Just obey the word. Just do the word of God. Hallelujah. Praise the name of Jesus.
Yes.
I'm just excited. I'm excited. We are excited about the things of God. We just see the Lord opening so many doors. And it is amazing what's happening in the Little Bly Church and the impact that the Little Bly Church is having. You know that a young girl, she's a married woman. She had an incurable disease, Lyme's disease. And it was wrecking her central nervous system. It was destroying her life, creating scars all over her body. She is verifiably, by all doctors' tests, completely cured. It has gone away. There's no trace of it. There's no trace of it. Now, this girl was raised in Bly. Everybody knows her. One person that doesn't know the Lord was concerned about another person said, when is Pastor Mark going to get back here? And this is, listen, the Lord creates a rumor. Pastor Brad's doing a great job. And the things that are happening is a result of everybody's participation. But you know what? It's just a rumor that God creates. It's just a rumor. Hallelujah. And besides that, we all in this thing together, and what anybody says about me, they say about Pastor Brad or vice versa. You see what I'm saying?
Yes.
Okay? And because we're not in competition. It's not, oh, I'm not getting my credit. The rumor mill is growing. We're getting ready to play. Daniel has been reaching out to the youth
ministry in Bonanza. And they just connected down there. We're getting ready to start a youth ministry in Bonanza. And then we're going to start a church in Klamath. We've actually started a plant of the church in an amazing place in Klamath. And Nikki's leading the way. Just a little house meeting. And then once a month we're going to start. They've got a big facility there. Once a month we're going to have a bigger meeting in the facility that they have there. And we're going to let the Klamath church grow out of that. And it's going to happen. And so, and then the Lord's opening up doors, and we're going to begin Connecticut. We're blessed to be with James at Connecticut at their conference. And then the Lord opened up also another door for us to be with Kevin Ortiz at his church in Texas for their beginning of the 2016 conference. We're just so excited about what God's doing. He's just opening more and more doors and more opportunities. And we're just going to see. On every level, on every area, we're going to see the things of the Spirit, the things of the kingdom, just break wide open on every side. Because we are not willing to live without it.
That's right.
And that's what I got to do, Chrissy. You will see these things in God, and you're passionate about it, and then you just aren't willing to live without it. It's more important to you than anything else. And then that gets Father's heart. If you can live without it, and if it's just another thing in the opportunity, well, you know what? It ain't going to work because it's too sacred. You got to hunger and thirst for it. It's got to be more important to you. It's got to be above all other things. It's got to be your one desire. And let us tell you right now, we are so thankful to the work and the help that we have received and the labors that we received from Pastor Brad and Margaret, because I'm telling you, they helped us so much. Brad's skill set is in construction, and he's helped us so much to get some of our basic facilities up and going. And it's been a lot of work. It's been a lot of work. In fact, Daryl's laying block for us again this week. And I mean, we've just done a lot of work. We've done a lot of work. If we would have had it paid, if we would have had to pay for all the things that we've done, we would have spent well over $1 million now. I mean, you usually just multiply, when you're doing it all by yourself, you multiply it between 7 and 10, and that's what it would cost if you had to hire it out. You see what I'm saying?
Yeah.
And then Michaela, the Lord gave us a whole unique approach to doing some things in animal husbandry that is going to be amazingly beneficial and profitable across every dimension of what we're doing. And we were able to take it to Michaela, and she implemented it, and it was just 100% success. And it was a lot of labor to get it up and going. In the past 4 months, she has labored with us to make this happen. And and I can't go into all the details of it. I'll just keep you here all night trying to explain these things to you. But we're so thankful for all the people who labored. And of course, Daniel and Summy. That's the name that Anna gave Summer. And of course, Daniel and Summer are getting married next week. Hallelujah. And I tell you, it is a match made in heaven. It is two people brought together by the power of God for the purposes of the kingdom of God. It is such a glorious and beautiful thing. It is such a blessing to us. Hallelujah. And of course, everybody's invited. It's just way up in Northern Oregon. And in a beautiful setting out there. And so, you know, we're just excited about it. And you know, a lot of their focus in ministry now is going to be in Oregon. And my goodness, so many of the things that we've been able to do and the way we've been able to grow the animal husbandry. Did you know if you have an animal husbandry program, you have to have full-time people to take care of a full-time need? Yep. Do you understand that?
Yes.
If you don't have the people, you can't do it. I can't take care of them by flying up every other week. I do a lot of work, but it's got to be somebody there every single day. And then, of course, then we started the fish again, and we got the raceway, and we got a bunch of fish swimming around. And they're growing radically. and they got to be fed continually and taken care of. And we praise the Lord for, you know, summer's been a big part of that. And we need about 10 full-time people right now for the things that we've got to do. And we've got to have people that are, we have to have people that are trained and skilled. And we're willing to train them. But, you know, and bless Joshua Men Across Heart. I love him with all of my heart. You may be listening tonight. And we put a lot into him and we trained him and then he left us. But now he's going to an orphanage in Colombia and with a 5-year commitment. And he's doing what we trained him to do for us, he's doing for them. So we're happy. Amen. So we said, so by way of a way that we didn't want to do it, send somebody else to the mission field with a skill set to go do those things. And so we're hoping and believing God that we'll be able, because it's challenging. It's always a great and a fun and exciting thing to do till you get out there and you're in rural remote land. And there's nobody to talk to. And for some people, for us, it's heaven. It's heaven because we were made for that kind of realm. This is awkward for us. It is challenging for me to live in a populous city. I belong in the mountain, but I'm here by the grace of God. So I go there and it's like, so I enjoy every bit of it. You continue to agree with us, walk with us, in agreement. The most important thing, more than your finances, is your agreement. Just walk with us in agreement. And if the Lord lays it upon your heart to go and participate with it and to commit, once again, people are coming from the nation of Nepal with a 3-year commitment, not a 3-month commitment. But they are from a remote place. I'm sorry, baby, I'm almost done. I just had to take this time to explain to everybody what's going on. Because usually I'm just preaching. And everybody is wondering, what is he doing now? But if the Lord lays it on your heart, you're going to have to come through our examination, evaluation process that we've now developed after watching 2 years of ups and downs. And once we get in, crawl up on the side of you, as it were, and evaluate where you really want to go with this, then we'll ask you to come with a 3-month commitment. And then we're going to give you a 3-month commitment with a huge workload. And if you survive that, then we talk about going on. Because if you can't make that, you'd never make the mission field. Never. Never. And we're going to, our training will really be rigorous training and preparation for a third world country. And where the Lord has the Mission Training Center right now, you can't more closely replicate a third world country than that. Because in a third world country, you may be in the midst of, you know, tens of thousands of hundreds of thousands of people, but you isolate because you don't speak the language and can't relate to the culture, right? So you're just like you're alone out on a ranch in the middle of nowhere. Does everybody know what the MTC is now? Does everybody know what the MTC is? It's a ministry. There's a part of the Abiding Place Full Gospel Fellowship. Amen. Hallelujah. Kara sotaranea. Hallelujah. Thank you, Jesus. Amen. Well, listen, we want you to just bless the Lord with your offerings and with your tithes. And we want you to find a bunch of people and you'll hug them and bless them and tell them that you love them. And if there's anybody who needs prayer for anything, we're here to pray with you and for you. If you're sick in your body, you don't need to be sick in your body. We don't want you to be sick in your body. The Lord doesn't want you to be sick in your body. If you have any kind of needs and breakthroughs, if you've got some kind of addiction going on, that is an oppressive evil spirit. If there's a recurrent sin in your life, we want to see that thing broken. We want you to be equipped to deal with it. We want you to be fortified and strengthened in God to no longer be overrun by the powers of darkness. So we're here to pray with you, minister to you, whatever you have need of. Hallelujah.